Everybody, and welcome to the 29th meeting of 2015 of the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee. The committee continued its fact-finding tour of Scotland this week, visiting the borders on Monday. We met with tenant farmers as well as representatives of the Roxburgh Estate and the Lowland Deer Network Scotland Group. I would like to thank those we met for their time and the views provided, which help us with our overview of land reform across the country. Before we move to the first item, remind everyone present to switch off mobile phones, as they may affect the broadcasting system. And you may notice that people are using tablets on the committee because the meeting papers are provided in digital format for those who are into the 21st century. First item today is agenda item one, about taking evidence on part 8 of the Land Reform Scotland Bill, which is on deer management. We've been joined by a panel of stakeholders this morning. Alec Hogg, Chair of the Scottish Gamekeepers Association, Robbie Kernahan, Unit Manager of Wildlife Operations SNH. We've got Richard Cooke, the Chair of the Association of Deer Management Groups and the Lowland Deer Network Scotland Group, Duncan Orr-Ewing, convener of Link Deer Task Force and Scottish Environment Link, and Douglas McAdam, Chief Executive of Scottish Land and Estates. Welcome everybody here, and we're going to straight into some questions. As you know, this committee made an incisive inquiry a couple of years ago into the management of deer, and we suggested that the voluntary approach to the preparation of deer management plans should continue. The Minister then decided to give deer management groups 2 years to complete these. And I want to ask you as a panel, just as a starter, do you think that that approach by the government is working? And does it give time to allow this voluntary approach to deliver? Just indicate and I'll bring you in. Okay, Richard Cooke.
Convener, yes, I believe it is working. I think the point I would want to make is that a lot of groups had deer management plans before the review, but that the deer management plans were operational in purpose. What has come into the picture and is very much now a dimension of deer management planning is representing the public, reflecting the public interest in deer management, and the new deer management plans that are being written at the moment, and I think we're in the mid-20s of plans, Robbie Kernahan will be able to confirm, in terms of plans that are already being written, with a number more in the pipeline, are all addressing, a lot of them replace old plans, and they do address the public interest aspect as well as the operational aspects of the deer management, of the deer management group's activities.
We'll look at some of the detail of this in a minute, but given the outline, you know, what, well, Robbie Kernahan, you were mentioned there, what's your view of the development of plans?
I think at the last session we had on deer that we did highlight that the package of measures which currently exists in Scotland can actually provide the basis for a modern approach to deer management in Scotland. But I think we also acknowledge that more needs to be done by owners, by DMGs, and indeed by public bodies to demonstrate a willingness to look beyond perhaps the private objectives of land management and think about demonstrating much more enhanced action to deliver public interest. So we have done an awful lot, I think, since those sessions back in late 2013, which, to be honest, I think we found hugely helpful because it did, I think, provide us with a focus to work more closely with ADMG and be clear about just exactly what we need DMGs to do, how we need them to operate openly, inclusively, transparently, but more importantly, what we need them to deliver. And that has provided quite a good focus about how we construct plans, what goes into them. And since the committee last considered it and the Minister responded, we have spent an awful lot of time working with ADMG to produce a benchmark, essentially clarifying our expectations of what a DMG should do, how it should operate, and also working through all of the kind of national policies, trying to translate them into a local level for DMGs, really to get their head around what this means for them practically to deliver a deer management plan. We've also undertaken a fairly substantial auditing kind of assessment process against all upland DMGs principally to be able to measure how far away from that benchmark they are, and also that has helped highlight just exactly what focus needs to go into deer management plans for them all too. So I think in short we found the committee sessions hugely helpful in providing some of that focus. And to be fair to the DMGs and Richard's Association, I think the penny has finally dropped that real and meaningful progress needs to be made in the next 18 months.
Okay. Doug McAdam then, Duncan or Ewing.
Thanks, Convener. I would echo both those statements, also to state that I also sit on the executive board of ADMG, so I do get a view of the progress that's being made. I mean, one of the points I would like to make is how crucial it is that what we're discussing doesn't prejudge the outcome of the 2016 review. And certainly from some of the previous evidence that I've seen, there seemed to be almost a suggestion that was a direction of travel towards statutory management. And I think, certainly from our point of view, it would be very important that we don't prejudge the outcome of that review, because we do see a sector that has taken the signals that have been given to them and is making progress.
Okay. Yeah.
Graham. Thank you, Convener. Where the penny hasn't dropped or not satisfactory progress is being made, Robbie Kernahan, in your experience, is it the case that there is a problem across the entire deer management group area, or is it the case that there may only be perhaps one estate that's a problem?
It's interesting, Graham, and it is a real mixed picture. I think what we've seen is that those people that are sitting in terms of the very important position of chair or secretary of these voluntary groups, it really needs them to drive the process forward. And across the board, we have seen a genuine and meaningful engagement from all of those individuals who are effectively tasked with leading these groups. And we are obviously giving them every encouragement to do so. So we are obviously providing financial support over last year and this year to help them construct these plans. Of the 44 deer management groups in the uplands which we've assessed, we've already issued 26 funding packages and another 7 anticipated. Some of those other groups are developing plans in-house, but our expectation is that all of them will have produced meaningful plans by the end of 2016. And I think that's a very good news story, but I would caveat that slightly, because developing a plan is one thing. But I think from my perspective, that's really just the first step, because the most important thing and the more challenging thing is actually delivering it, making it happen. But it's still early days, but I think progress, certainly over the last 12 months, has been particularly good.
Okay, so Duncan or Ewing now.
Yeah, so we think the intervention of the RACI committee hearing evidence in relation to deer management has been hugely helpful, and the involvement of the minister in this issue as well. During the RACI evidence, the committee heard about the huge ecological issues that are faced in the uplands of Scotland, in particular, from high deer populations in some places, and this is affecting our ability to deliver a whole range of public outcomes, from the protection of designated sites through the expansion of native woodland, the protection of peatlands hitting climate change targets and so forth. And whilst there has been progress, I would concur with Robbie that the focus to date has very much been on process and getting deer management plans in place, and having clear deadlines has been very helpful. But, you know, in the future, post 2016, we really need more deadlines and a focus on outcomes and implementation.
Okay, Richard Cooke.
Convener, the commentary on deer numbers is always that there are far too many deer in Scotland and that the environment is in crisis. And I have to contest that, because in the deer areas with which I'm most familiar, deer numbers have been reduced markedly. I would look to Robbie to confirm whether the national picture reflects that. In the East Grampians, for example, when I was the secretary of the East Grampian Deer Management Group, we counted 36,000 deer in the early 1980s, and the number at last count was 17,000, a reduction of more than 50%. I also would refer to a piece of information I got from SNH yesterday, when I specifically asked them what the condition of the designated features on the designated sites where deer are present in Scotland as a whole is, and I'll just quote it to you. 85.3% of features within the deer range are in either favourable condition, recovering due to management, or unfavourable, but with the site condition monitoring herbivore targets being met, in other words, deer numbers being in accordance with SNH targets. In other words, the proportion of designated sites that are still suffering from excessive deer impacts is 14.7%, and while that is not something to be complacent about, nor I would suggest is it a crisis.
Well, I think we'll explore some of these in detail in a minute or two. Did you have anything to add, Alec, at the moment? Sorry, it's automatic.
You know, we're worried about the socio-ecological side of things, jobs.
Yeah.
You know, we've got to remember it's got to be in the public interest to have men and families up these glens. And if we get, if our deer numbers get so low in some places, there's certainly jobs been under threat.
Well,
we need to be aware of that all the time.
We will, and we'll explore that point, and thank you for making
you.
It. I think we want to explore this in a bit more detail, but just before we do, Richard Cooke talked about the reduction from 28,000 to 17,000, was it?
36 to 17.
Yeah. That doesn't necessarily tell us whether that's still a figure that is not in balance with the ecology.
You make an absolutely crucial point, Convener. It's about impacts, not numbers. The quotation I gave you from SNH, information given to me yesterday, was about impacts. And I think the other point that always has to be borne in mind, that deer are not the only herbivores occupying the open hill range. They share their range with sheep, and sheep numbers have also declined markedly over the last 10 years by, I think, a million, which is about 30%. So overall grazing pressure and trampling pressure is undoubtedly coming down at a significant rate. It does take some time for exposed habitats to respond to that change in utilisation.
But there's particular areas where sheep numbers have reduced, and we're talking about much of my part of the world in the far northwest, you know, in the mainland in particular, some of the islands. That's the areas where there have been fewer sheep. But, you know, overall, the central highlands and so on, you know, there seem to be stories about pressures there that continue to be raised with us. So we'll explore this in some more detail just now. I want to look at, you know, the content of the plans and the processes that the deer management groups have been undertaking. And Mike Russell's going to fire away.
Just before I come to inputs and outputs, I just want to raise the figures, Richard, that you just gave. Your own publication, LDNS News, on page 6, on the Native Woodlands Survey of Scotland, just so that we're absolutely accurate in terms of figures, says only 46% of native woods are in satisfactory ecological condition. On a comparable basis, 54% of native woodland designated sites as of June 2014 are in favourable condition, a decrease of 5% since 2010. So there are figures, perhaps, that give a less rosy view than the one you were giving.
Your
own publication.
Yeah, exactly. And the NWSS report was extremely useful and will be a reference point, which is of value for some time. And I don't for a moment, and I said that there was no grounds for complacency, I don't for a moment say that there isn't a problem. What I'm saying that the problem is proportionate and can be managed. So far as the Native Woodland Survey was concerned, we had one issue with that, in that it had a default presumption that if an area of native woodland was not in favourable or improving condition, that it was due to deer. I know from the estate I'm responsible for that the area where that woodland was deemed to be in that unsatisfactory state, there are no deer present because they're excluded by fencing, and the damage was actually done by sheep. So that there are nuances of this that require further exploration. I think the point is that if the woods are not in satisfactory condition, then something needs to be done about it, but it's not just about the deer, deer are a part of it.
I was at an event on Friday in Strachur, in my constituency, which was organised by forestry and deer interests. And the inescapable conclusion of that event, I want to come on to the way that deer management plans are put together, deer management groups operate, but the inescapable conclusion was that the problem was not being solved, and that the Forestry Commission, for example, had great intent, but it wasn't solving the problem, neither were private landowners, and that the figures being used were inaccurate. and that there was a sort of complacency about the situation which was causing enormous difficulty. So I think there are many people who disagree with your take upon this and who want to see more radical action. But let's come to the question of deer management group processes. Can whoever wishes to talk me through that process, what does a deer management group meeting feel like and look like? Who's there? What's the public participation? What's the outcome? Just talk me through this, about what you believe is happening.
Well, typically, because none of them are exactly the same and they all reflect the local circumstances in which they're located, deer management groups will be attended by a mix of the proprietors of the estates concerned, the land holdings concerned, by a number of the people who work on them, and by representatives. I mean, those are the prime movers, so to speak. They will also be attended by, almost without exception, Scottish Natural Heritage through their wildlife management officer. They will almost always have a representative from Forest Enterprise because there are blocks of forestry land within nearly all the deer management group areas. But typically, they will also have representation from the local wildlife officer, from the police, there will be a number of other interests too. If the mix of estates concerned includes charitable bodies, they will be represented. If they include public bodies, they will be represented in that capacity. Where I think there is still work to do is in how they engage with the public, and that's a point that was made by the in the review and which we're taking very seriously. And ADMG has been spending some time in thinking about the best mechanisms for this. We've developed a simple off-the-peg website, which we'll be launching in about a month to all the deer management groups so that they can use that as their principal window, so to speak, so that people can get information about deer management plans, about minutes, and about the action plans of individual deer groups. So we're addressing that. We accept that that's a matter of significant concern for the committee and that they expect to see progress on that.
Why don't the public show any interest? Is it because they don't have any interest or because they don't think their interest would be of any influence at all in that grouping?
Different in different circumstances, but there are I certainly know of a number of circumstances where deer management groups have attempted to engage with the public and find that there is very little interest. Not a deer-related issue, but I recently, this is just an example of rural communities sometimes being quite content with what is done around them and not wishing to intervene or take an interest. I recently, on the estate I look after, offered an area of woodland to be community woodland around the settlement in the glen concerned. And I held a meeting at which as many of the community as were able to attend were present, and they took the view that they would rather not have the burden of looking after it and that they were perfectly happy for it to be looked after by the estate.
Oh, I could take you to lots of groups who would cut your hand off to get an area of woodland, but there we are. I suppose that's the queer as folk.
Duncan, are you doing?
Yeah. Just to say, I mean, we think there could be greater transparency, like you're suggesting, in the deer management planning process. Actually, we're surprised that in this bill there is no link back to Part 4 of the Act around transparency. I mean, if you use the comparison of the Forestry Commission public register, all new plantings, all forest design plans have to go through a standard system, which is published on the Forestry Commission website. We think there should be a similar approach on the SNH website, that all deer management plans, especially, should be published on the website, especially now that public money is involved through SRDP. SNH are also contributing $200,000 at the moment to the production of deer management plans. And you're correct when you said earlier about there are genuine concerns, really, about deer numbers in some places and impacts on the natural heritage and the impacts particularly on designated sites. SNH are targeting in particular deer management as one of the key issues if we're going to resolve some of the outstanding issues around damage to features of designated sites. And to achieve woodland expansion, native woodland expansion, you need deer densities of under 5, probably closer to 2 per square kilometre, which we do not have in many places in Scotland.
Forest Enterprise is setting itself on this are being achieved.
None. Correct. Well, they take a third of the deer cull as well, remember.
Indeed. And they're still not achieving their targets.
Doug McAdam.
Thank you. If I could pick up on Richard's point, I think, you know, when we look at how do your management groups engage with the public? It's got to be very much, you know, horses for courses. Different groups will want to do it in different ways. In some places, it will be easier to engage with the community, and in others, it won't. So as an example, for instance, the Monolith Deer Management Group recently did have such a meeting, and they got quite a good attendance. But again, that's a pretty engaged, populated area where there is interest, and I guess being in part of the national park maybe helped that. There are other areas where that's probably not so easy or appropriate, in which case I think the portal that Richard's outlined does give that public view, public window, which I think will be extremely useful.
I just wonder if I could please say, my last question on this, just put it to the panel, who are people of great experience in this. If you took the long view of deer management in Scotland, you would, I think, inevitably, but you may wish to challenge this, come to the conclusion that the state and legislative action so far has failed, and that particularly public bodies have failed when they have left this matter, as they have done from the establishment of the Red Deer Commission onwards, to landowners and large public undertakings. It has not worked. The problem has got progressively worse. The problem in forestry now is insurmountable in some areas in terms of growing trees, and particularly native woodlands. The solutions to date have not cut the mustard, and there needs to be much more radical action taken to stop this problem getting even worse. And the solutions that come from public bodies, Forest Enterprise and SNH, well-intentioned as they are, do not work too.
So Duncan Orr-Ewing and Douglas McAdam.
Mr. Russell is right to remind us, in the 1990s, I think it was 1994, we had a report from SNH called Red Deer and the Natural Heritage, which at that time suggested that the red deer population needed to be reduced from 200,000 animals to 100,000. We now have a population in the Highlands of Scotland of over 400,000 red deer. So you're correct.
Doug McAdam.
I think what we have to remind ourselves is we've got a voluntary system at the moment that is delivering in the public interest across a number of areas, including deer management, which is done at very little cost to the public purse.
What's the definition of delivering? The numbers are rising and damage is getting worse. That's not delivering.
I think there's dispute about whether the numbers are rising or not. And I think this review that is going to take place next year in 2016 is going to look at exactly what you're saying, Mike, about whether it is delivering or not. So, you know, perhaps we should await the outcome of this detailed review that people are working towards.
They know it's not. Your members know it's not.
Well, I would dispute that.
Well, that's what I hear from throughout my constituency and throughout the rural sector in Scotland. The reality is that the numbers are growing and that the management methods are not working. They're well-intentioned. In some places they're having some effect. But overall, this problem has continued to get worse for the last 100 years, probably, and action is required that is effective now. And the voluntary action has not been effective.
Could I just come back on that point? I think we also, and it maybe goes back to your previous point about native woodlands as well, we also have to differentiate between the red deer range and management through deer management groups there and the lowland situation, where undoubtedly the population in the lowlands is growing, there's a problem, and it needs dealt with, and maybe we'll come on to talk about that later. But we do have to differentiate between the two. And so I guess quite a part of your constituency is maybe feeling the effects of that lowland issue as well.
No.
Yeah. Not true.
Yeah, well, first of all, SNH, Robbie Kernahan.
Yeah, some interesting observations. I think I need to come back on some of them. There's no doubt a meeting in Cowell of last week will have highlighted the fact that there is no established deer management group in that area has resulted in a lack of cohesive deer management because people will continue to act in isolation. I think when you're managing red deer as a resource, we've long recognised that meaningful collaboration needs to take place, and it's a shame that deer management groups in Cowell have kind of fallen by the wayside, because that does illustrate there is a problem and people are not happy with the current provisions, so therefore something needs to be done. I think coming back to the legislation and how effective it is, it was only relatively recently, I think it was 1996, before natural heritage was actually even encompassed in the Deer Scotland Act. So prior to that, it wasn't even really considered to be much of an issue. I think we've seen since the 96 Act and how the Red Deer Commission, the Deer Commission for Scotland and now SNH have positioned themselves has always been to try and encourage and facilitate effective management, and only where that doesn't work have we more formally intervened. And I think we can actually demonstrate that some of the current provisions within the legislation can actually work, because I think we've got some very good examples of making meaningful reductions of deer numbers. And I can cite two or three examples, Kinlochin, Bradalbin, and others, where we have significantly changed deer densities.
Some of that question a little later on, but two or three other people want to come in on Mike's point. So the first of these is Richard, then Duncan, and then Alec Hogg.
Yes, I mean, you obviously, well, I now understand what you're talking about, Mr. Russell, and I don't know a great deal about the Cowell area because it's not within our network, because as Robbie said, there isn't a deer management group in the area. We have actually been speaking to SNH about Cowell because we recognise that it's an area where collaborative management is necessary. And I think it's as a part of this process, shall we call it the 2016 process, we're not only trying to get the existing deer management group areas up to speed, we're also looking at areas where there is a case for introducing deer management groups or similar collaborative mechanisms where they aren't present at the moment, and Cowell is one of those. So it's not that this has escaped our notice. I think in general, the statistic I gave you earlier about the impact on designated sites says something about impacts. You used a quotation from our newsletter, which is the Lowland Deer Network newsletter, but the point is well made, that most of the native woodlands are not in a condition which we would want them to be, which I accept. But I made the point earlier that that isn't always just deer. But I think we have to ask ourselves, what is the role of native woodlands? They're not just there for their own sake. They're there to provide shelter, feeding, amenity, landscape. They're not just there for timber production, they're not just there for their own sake. They're multifunctional, they play a role in the countryside, they have a utilitarian role as well as an amenity role. And from that point of view, the fact that they're providing accommodation in the winter for wild deer or for sheep or for other herbivores for that matter, other species of deer, it means that one is reducing the pressure on the exposed land nearby.
And that right now. So if that was an argument, you would get to the stage where there were none left by allowing this to happen.
Well, exactly, and it's important that they should regenerate, and in general that can be done on a rotational basis by the use of fencing, which indeed is, and there are good examples of that all over Scotland.
Okay. I don't want to dominate this, I did promise the last question, but I just want to make the point, I'm not specifically, although I'm using Cowell as an example, I receive information from other areas, and you know, as a former environment minister, I've had some experience of this problem. My long view of this is firmly of the view that the system to date has not worked, that good things have been done. Nobody is denying good things have been done in places, but they require a more radical approach in order to ensure that this problem is contained and kept and got under control. And we need, therefore, stronger statutory approaches, because the voluntary approach has, by and large, failed. That's my view.
Duncan or Ewing?
Yeah, just briefly. We have one of the least regulated deer management systems in Europe, and perhaps some of the biggest ecological issues that are arising from large deer populations in some areas. And if you compare our red deer populations with the likes of Sweden and Norway, our populations are in some places tenfold higher. And if you refer back to the Land Reform Review Group report, there was a suggestion in that, or there were a suggestion that urgent action in relation to deer management was required. They recommended that SNH should set deer culls and that there should be compulsory deer returns and that kind of thing. And we would certainly support those kind of measures, and we hope they will be in place in due course.
So, look, I'm going to give Alec Hogg a wee shot first, you know, just before we come back to Richard. Yeah.
Thanks. Mike, to go back to your problem at Strachar, there's two points I'd like to make. One is, I used to work for the Forestry Commission on the west coast of Scotland at Loch Awe. When I worked for them in the late 70s, early 80s, there was 33 rangers in that wee constituency alone, wildlife rangers. There's none left in Scotland from the Forestry Commission, compared to what they had. Right, you know, and I've asked your mind in the past from your environment minister, why is the Forestry Commission not starting to employ young rangers? There's no wildlife rangers. And that is part of the problem, because they've no ground to manage anymore. What we're finding is contractors are coming in, shooting the deer in the spotlight, and then they're not being part of the community. So And also, there is lots of locals in these areas who'd be prepared to go and take on a wee bit of ground and control deer. They never get the chance. So that is two major problems within the deer management.
Well, we don't have the Forestry Commission here, but we note your remarks, and we can explore them in due course. Graham Day wanted to ask a supplementary at the moment.
Yeah.
We'll bring in Richard.
And timely, given the contribution that Mr. Hogg's just made. If deer management groups are to operate successfully, we need to be able to call on all available expertise. And I'm sure Mr. Hogg will remember in the previous work the committee did in this area, we highlighted the need for the gamekeepers to have a voice in deer management groups. I just want to ask him if the voice of your members and their expertise is now bringing influence to the work of DMGs, or are we still in the same position?
No, we're much more involved now. And we're being asked for advice much more, and we're getting a lot of the stalkers go along to the meetings, and it's far more broad brush now.
Okay.
Claudia Beamish.
Right, thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Could I just ask, particularly Robbie and Douglas, but any other brief comments as well? Just about the process in terms of public money now being put in to support the deer management. Groups, which I understand is in the kickstart process. Is there an expectation still that estates should be putting money into this to support it and going forward? You know, and how does that process work? Because this is public money that's being put in, and rightly so, where there are areas that it's not functioning at all. But just looking to the future. Where is this money going to come from to manage the advertising, for instance, for public participation, the appropriate advertising, or whatever the issue might be?
Okay, Robbie.
Happy to start. I mean, again, just going back to first principles here, deer management groups operate on a voluntary basis. Therefore, they are organised voluntarily, and most of the organisation of those groups come from their members. There's very little money from the state goes into helping facilitate deer management groups function effectively. Obviously, SNH and FCS staff attend, provide advice and support and guidance as necessary, and provide that kind of public interest voice, as it were. But we also recognise that collaborative deer management does require a certain amount of facilitation expertise. And one of the problems, actually, we've always had with DMGs is that they sometimes struggle with capacity. And the expertise in order to mediate conflicts or resolve some of these things. But it is in the public interest to do so. Therefore, we are quite content to be able to provide some kind of incentive to make groups function more effectively and plan more effectively. So with that in mind, we have managed to secure funding through SRDP to help groups function, and that can be drawn down through the new Collaborative Action Fund. So there is money available to plan at a landscape scale to help groups like DMGs operate on that basis and deliver deer management more effectively. Since the committee last considered deer management, obviously SRDP was in a bit of a hiatus, which is why SNH and Scottish Government came up with a sum of money to help groups produce some of these plans, with the express expectation that, having gone through the process of better identifying what public interests we were expecting DMGs to deliver, these plans would be designed to help address some of those concerns. We made available £100,000 last year and again this year. Most of that will have been drawn down by the end of the financial year to help groups produce plans. Moving forward, again, there will be public money available to help monitor delivery of these plans in terms of money for habitat impact assessment to actually measure the impacts deer are having and also the benefits of these plans being put together.
Briefly, yes. Richard Cooke, first of all.
Just to make it clear that those funds that are being made available from SNH are made available on a match fund basis. So the deer groups concerned are all raising new money to pay for their 50% of the deer management planning process. If I could just pick up a point from Graham Day. Three of our deer management groups are now chaired by gamekeepers, by stalkers. And I'm very keen that should continue. I completely agree with, I think, what is your premise, that the people on the ground are the people who know best and should drive the deer management process. Very keen to encourage that. And just back to Mike Russell's point, I'm very concerned that deer are being portrayed possibly by you and the people who speak to you, as of no value in themselves, as being vermin that should be removed like rats. If that is the case, I think we must bear in mind that there are considerable benefits, including environmental benefits, as well as employment and social benefits, that flow from the management of the deer population in a sustainable way. We are working very strongly towards the sustainable management of the deer population in general. There are areas, and always will be areas. Deer management is a reactive process. It reacts to change. Of course, there are areas where there is work to be done. I firmly believe that the voluntary principle, the voluntary system, with the flexibility that underlies it, is the best possible way of addressing that.
Well, I've heard that before.
What I said, yeah. Or what I intended to say, and I'd be grateful if it wasn't misrepresented.
Yeah. Thank you. I don't think we need to be talking about rats and things like that, because indeed, I don't think it actually helps us in what this committee does. We are about the environment. We do recognise all the parts of the environment, even if some other people don't. Doug McCallum.
Yeah, can I come back to the original question? I would agree with what Robbie says, and I think the provision of public money to help that initial process and get going is a very good use of that money, and I think we could see parallels in other areas where we're trying to break ground. What I would like to say, though, is that, of course, the bulk of the cost of deer management across Scotland is still borne by the private sector in terms of the day-to-day management and the cost that comes with that. So this is a very small part compared to that whole. So I think that's just a very important point that we should all recognise.
There was a point about the portal and so on. Does that mean that agendas, meeting papers, minutes and so on are going to be available on that portal? And it's the sort of thing which you would expect perhaps to be published on notice boards in village halls and so on.
Indeed. As I say, different deer groups will find different ways of doing this to address their local community interest, but the web portal, I anticipate, over a period will become pretty standard and will be the best means to find out what's going on.
Okay. Graham Day, next question.
Thank you, Convener. Looking to the approach taken in the bill, I'd welcome your views on whether SNH should have a power to amend plans rather than just approve or reject these. Should it have the power to impose its own plan? If unhappy with that prepared by a DMG, does it actually have the suitable expertise to do this?
Right, OK. Richard Cooke, then Duncan Orr-Ewing. Yeah.
In practical terms, that's what happens, because the development of deer management plans is as I say, in practice, a process of negotiation in which SNH is very closely involved, particularly in view of the public money aspect of it. So that is what happens. They amend as well as approve, and I think it would be fair to say that if they disapproved, the grant wouldn't be paid. So that wouldn't work. I think the measures proposed in the bill, which are to give SNH additional powers to intervene in specific circumstances where things aren't working, I don't have a problem with that. I think if there should be an individual or two or three individuals who are not collaborating with their neighbours in the management of a shared deer population, and normal powers of persuasion aren't sufficient to change that, then I don't think we have a problem with SNH having the opportunity to intervene if it needs to do so. But I would remind the committee that the Section 8 powers that SNH already has under the deer legislation have not had to be used, for which I give credit to SNH, because they like to use their influence and persuasive powers rather than a big stick as far as possible. Mm.
That's an interesting diplomatic gloss on
the situation. We'll hear in a wee while. Duncan Orr-Ewing.
So SNH are supposed to be publishing shortly a review of progress with deer management planning progress in Scotland. That hasn't been published yet. We do, though, understand that there are some private landowners that are not following this process. They're outside deer management groups or whatever. We do agree that the proposals that SNH or are proposed, the new powers to SNH to intervene in the deer management planning process, are required. We also think they should be implemented now rather than later, as recommended in the Land Reform Review Group report, which came out after the RACI evidence that was taken a couple of years ago. We think those powers will be required in any case, because there will be some landowners that are outside this system.
We're dealing with this bill as it is, and the proposals in it as they are, not implementing things earlier, but we'll hear what you say. So, Douglas.
Thank you. Yes, I mean, our view would be that, you know, SNH already have Section 7 and Section 8 powers. They do have the power to intervene. They do have the power to drive deer management groups in a certain direction, deer management plans in a certain direction. And that's important, and it's important that we maintain that balance of the public and the private interest, and I think, and how that's developed. And to move to a more top-down, really more draconian process, I think, could upset that balance and could upset really what we're trying to achieve. So I think even Duncan mentioned earlier about looking across the water to Scandinavia, I think even when you look there at the processes that they have, they're not even that top down. And so I think we should take note of that as well.
We could have a long philosophical discussion about local government and so on in Scandinavia compared to here in local decision making, but we don't have that here yet. Robbie Kernahan.
Yeah, just coming back to Graham's question and picking up on a point Mike Russell made. The actual process by which these plans are constructed is crucial here. And what we have attempted to do with every DMG is take some of these national policies, for example, Scotland's Biodiversity 2020 route map, Scotland's forestry strategy, and distill them down into meaningful bite-sized chunks for deer management groups across the country. So we have effectively tried to spell out the ask of what the policy direction is across the country and to try and help DMGs really understand what that means for them. And that, from an ecological point of view, if healthy ecosystems are actually what's driving quite a lot of the debate, and I think it is, quite rightly, we're asking groups to begin to think about, well, how do they address the 56% of native woodlands which are in poor condition at a local level? What meaningfully can they do to demonstrate that they're actually aware of that problem and are addressing it locally? In terms of woodland expansion, across these groups of estates, what's realistic for the groups to consider in terms of new woodland creation, designated features, how many features can we begin to address? So we're really beginning to spell out what the ask is. And there are some things in there which groups have to do because it's a legal requirement. There are some things in there which they should do because it's a sensible from a deer management point of view in terms of creating new woodland, for example. But also these things, they're being encouraged to think about them. These are not regulatory requirements. They're being encouraged to think about government policy and to try and implement that voluntarily, and we will incentivise them to do so. But quite a lot of these discussions are actually about, well, what do these groups consider to be the priorities for them? Because the priorities up in Northwest Sutherland and Caithness for peatlands, for example, may be very different to the priorities down in Angus Glens, where maybe woodland is more of a priority. So it's not a one-size-fits-all. We're asking these groups to actively think about what they consider the priorities to be locally and then to try and address some of those priorities in the plans, which I think we think is quite a sensible way of doing it. But SNH are fully engaged in that process in terms of our staff going along and helping facilitate some of these conversations and supporting and providing directions to what we think should go in these plans, because it is really about delivering the public interest. As I said, it's early days. We've only seen two or three of these draft plans with these public interest outcomes built into them. And I know that this is quite an ambitious ask which we're putting to deer management groups, because I suspect they will not be able to do everything in here. But it's the start of a process, and we're trying to get them to be quite ambitious about what they can do within the next 5 years. And if there's things which they can't tackle, not to lose sight of them, because these are big issues and we need the DMGs to grasp them.
We need to kind of move on, but just before we come to Section 7 and Section 8, Dave Thompson, I think you've got a question for the SGA.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. It's to do with the socio-economic impacts of these things, and I noticed from your submission from the SGA, you say that you would hope that deer management practice, which goes against the socio-economic interests of communities, will be similarly liable for penalty. You're quoting a bit further up. It's a very good point, I think. You know, I've no doubt about that. There is a real concern, and I understand the concern about jobs, you know, and about the effect on people in the areas. But maybe a little bit of comfort, and I'll get your comment on this. Section 4 of the Regulatory Reform Scotland Act 2014 already places a duty on regulatory bodies, and I'll just read it to you. In exercising its regulatory functions, each regulator must contribute to achieving sustainable economic growth, except where that is inconsistent with its functions. Now, that's legalese. I dare say we could argue around exactly what it means, but it would appear that there's already a duty to take into account socio-economic factors. So I think it's probably already there, but I'd be interested in the comments, not just of the SGA, but from SNH. How do you, and this is only a year old, this piece of legislation, how do you balance these things and how do you take this into account? So I think, and if anybody else wants to comment as well, that would be fine.
Happy to go first. You're absolutely right, and part of our founding legislation means that we actually do have balancing duties in place in carrying all of our functions. So we are already obliged to take into account the interests of owner-occupiers of land about the needs of agriculture and forestry and the natural heritage in reaching decisions about the appropriate density and numbers of deer. Specifically, we're talking about the Deer Scotland Act, but of course that applies to our natural heritage functions too. So whilst the regulator's code and the duty placed upon us is relatively new, legislatively speaking, there has already been an expectation for some time that we take into account the interests of owner-occupiers and indeed the socio-economics associated with any of our decision-making. So whilst we welcome the new code, I think our view has always been one of balance, actually, to make sure we do get the balance between ecological outcomes, social outcomes and economic outcomes in everything that we do. And that is obviously a key part of any of our decision-making when we're thinking about deer reduction, for example. What impact will that have on local economies and jobs?
I just wonder if Solomon works for you, because it can't be easy to get that balance right.
It's not, but that is effectively what we're tasked with. That is really what we're there to try and mediate, facilitate between the public interest, between what the legislation expects of us in terms of preventing damage, but also taking into account the needs of agriculture, forestry and indeed sporting objectives, which is why we perhaps get it in the neck from everybody, Dave, but that's part of the job, I think.
And the SGA, are you comforted by the fact that this legislation exists and from what Robbie Kernahan has just said?
I never knew about that legislation, but it sounds like there's a wee bit protection there. Mm-hmm. The other thing I'd like to say is, when you've got a man at the Glen, he's not just a deer stalker, he's, in a way, he's policing that Glen as well. And it's really important in this day and age to recognise that he's on that ground 7 days a week.
Okay, thank you.
But several other people want to comment, the whole panel, in other words. So we'll start off with Duncan or Ewing, and then Doug, and then Richard. Okay?
Yeah, I would just make the point that in the context of sustainable deer management, we actually need more deer management to happen, not less. So actually, you would envisage that we need to be have circumstances where you actually facilitate the ability for more people to carry out deer management, and sometimes because of the systems that we have in place, that prevents some of, this wider engagement in deer management that you would hope could arise.
Yeah, I would just say I very much welcome what you point out, and I think this actually allows us to look at deer from a slightly different angle, which is very much as a natural, sustainable resource. And I think having the right economic sustainability requirements built in is very important. We've got a resource there that we've got to harvest, and we've got to do it sustainably, so we need to make sure that the numbers are there to do so. So, we very much welcome that.
And Richard?
Well, Duncan largely made my point for me. Deer management needs people. And so far as the community benefit from deer management is concerned, I think the committee will have heard on Monday that the grassroots are very much involved, particularly in the lowlands, in deer management, and certainly the Lowland Deer Network is very keen indeed to see that proliferate and be the general pattern.
Right, we'll stick to deer management at the moment, but so what if the plans, the management plans, aren't agreed? And Sarah Boyack is going to lead on this.
Thank you very much, Convener. We've been spending a lot of time talking about where things are working, and we want to explore the issue of where control agreements have been introduced, where they're voluntary, and we particularly want to get a sense of how Sections 7 and 8 work together, because we've never had the powers in Section 8 actually used. So I want to tease out the calculations behind that. And in the evidence from SNH, he spent a bit of time talking about how Section 7 actually works in practice. Can you give us a sense of how fast it is, or how straightforward it is to get a seven-section agreement on using control agreements for deer management?
Yes, I can, and I think we've currently got 9 control agreements across the country, ranging from small agreements with 2 or 3 properties through to a fairly significant agreement in Breadalbin, where we've got the whole deer management group signed up to a Section 7 control agreement. It involves 27 estates, and we've taken a population over 75,000 hectares down from about 12, 13,000 to 8,000. Another agreement over in Kinlochen with 10 estates, we've taken the population down from just over 12,000 to 5,000 deer. So I think that demonstrates that we can negotiate meaningful agreements over large tracts of Scotland with very different and complex ownership patterns. Obviously, the length of time it takes to negotiate a solution will depend on the number of people you're trying to negotiate with. So some of those negotiations might take longer than others. But I think what the Wildlife and Natural Environment Act did in 2011 is try and ensure that Section 7 and the link to Section 8 are more integrated, and the fact that we can put a very clear timescale on which we would seek to try and secure a voluntary agreement. And that is time-bound to 6 months now. And we've got good experience of being able to secure some of those complex agreements within that time period. So I think that just, again, does reiterate the point I tried to make earlier, that the current provisions can work, and we've got good examples of where they can work, where we can secure environmental gains. And in each of those agreements, we can demonstrate meaningful progress in terms of habitat outcomes, where habitats are improving as a result of those interventions, but at the same time ensure that they still remain reasonably compatible with ongoing sporting management. So I think that, to me, is quite reassuring. The process, I think, is reasonably well understood by those people that have been exposed to it, but generally when we introduce the concept of a control agreement, it's not universally well received, because people still think that it's state intervention, which is not necessarily always necessary. And there is a little bit of a selling job to be done, that this is a voluntary agreement, we can negotiate, we're willing to be sensible and reasonable, but we need to be clear about what success will look like, and success will be dictated to by habitat response and environmental outcomes. I don't know if that goes as far as you would like in terms of answering a specific question. In terms of the use of Section 8, mm-hmm. I think we tend to flex the muscles as and when we need to if we're finding some of these negotiations become difficult, because the very fact that we can threaten the use of Section 8, where there is less room for manoeuvre, less room for negotiation, actually does help those discussions reach a voluntary outcome. So we're never far away from that if we're actually having some of those very difficult conversations.
I think that's really useful, because it's clear that Section 8 hasn't been used. We've not seen control schemes actually imposed, but in your evidence from SNH, you spend quite a lot of time highlighting what you perceive as the risks of using Section 8. And one of the key things that struck me was whether you see it as a priority to use Section 8 because of the process of assessing whether Section 8 would be a useful power. You clearly use it as a backstop to bang heads together. Yeah. But let's say you've got a Section 7 agreement. Most people are playing ball, but maybe one or two aren't. Can I just tease out this issue of the one-off assessment? You highlight that issue is quite a risky way to go, and you question whether a one-off assessment would actually do the trick, and you question the extent to which you've got to go through a whole process before you get to that point. Do you think the Section 8 control schemes, as they're currently identified, are appropriate? Is it too tough a process for you to actually use? Is it only useful to use a backstop? That's the kind of impression I've got from reading your evidence.
I think moving forward, if we're going to move forward with a Section 8 control scheme, we as SNH, a regulatory body, need to be absolutely clear that deer are actually the primary cause of damage. And we are obviously reassured when we've actually followed a course of events where we can clearly demonstrate damage associated with deer management. But this is really, I think, all about our risk appetite. And I think it is reasonable for us now to conclude that off the basis of a one-off assessment, with our knowledge about impacts deer are having and the number of deer involved, that if we can't secure a voluntary agreement, then we could progress to Section 8. But it does carry an increased risk of successful challenge because, as we know, ecological relationships are complicated. There are other herbivores involved, which is why I think we would have more confidence if we can actually be more assured in our assessment that damage is actually down to deer and there's a clear audit trail which allows us to reach that conclusion.
Duncan?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I mean, we would certainly say Section 7 and Section 8 are useful tools in the toolbox. They can be quite lengthy to negotiate and, you know, we would argue that a swifter system is required. But I would also just remind the committee that these Section 7 agreements are very much geographically focused. So they're focused around areas, particularly around improvement of the condition of designated sites and for road safety. But the range of public outputs that we're now requiring from our uplands now go much wider. The protection of peatlands, native woodland expansion, these are all far wider public objectives that we now require from our uplands beyond designated sites and the road safety issues that are covered by Section 7. So we think there is a case for expanding the scope of SNH's involvement across a range of issues in the uplands.
Richard Cooke.
Thank you. I would just say that I'd like to share Robbie Kernahan's analysis of the value and benefit of Section 8. I think they have been helpful. I would anticipate that as the deer management plans, which are now being developed, are rolled out in practical terms, that they will hopefully remove the need for intervention of the sort that SNH have had to apply in terms of Section 7 with Section 8 in the background. And I think they will also address Duncan's point that they can look at the wider environment beyond designated sites, which have indeed been the focus of intervention under Section 7.
Okay. All right. It would be remiss of us not to mention the name Ard Farr before we leave this particular point in the agenda. And it throws up the contrast between current discussions by a neighbouring landowner to say that there's far fewer deer than were measured previously. But on the other hand, a failure by three landowners, only three, not 27, over 2 years to get to a discussion about a land management order. And the John Muir Trust are not prepared to accept a land management order that includes fencing. And that's the only way you can pay for fencing. And a Section 8 order, you know, has not been applied to a situation. Now, I'm only reading in the local press about the numbers of deer that are said to be fewer than there were when they were last counted. But I'm also aware that, as I said earlier, and Richard Cooke agreed, the actual impacts of how many deer there are can still be far out of balance with the needs of that particular landscape to regenerate. So what is going to resolve something like that if three landowners can't be got moving within a 2-year period? Who's going to pick that up? Richard, okay.
Shall I stick my head in that noose to start with? I think the asset situation is an extremely interesting one because it's the crucible of all the difficult issues and potential conflicts that deer management groups potentially face. And in that particular case, you've got an absolute standoff between the competing objectives of the different landowners, all of whom have valid aspirations for their pieces of land. And in circumstances like that, I do feel that there is a use for the intervention powers of the state through SNH, because it has proved over a really rather a long and unreasonably long period impossible to get the parties to find some compromise and some middle way which addresses the common ground. And it's difficult to see how this is all going to go. But these issues are, albeit pretty extreme in discussion in ASINT, are quite typical of the issues that are under discussion in groups right across Scotland.
Okay. Robbie Kernahan.
Just to bring the committee up to date with where we are on ASINT, and we did rehearse some of these arguments when we met 18 months ago. We have effectively asked the ASINT Peninsula to develop a deer management plan along the lines of the same ask that we have put to all our deer management groups. And with the best will in the world, I think what we've seen being produced falls significantly short of what we had hoped we would see. Some of that is because of the kind of very complex and competing land management objectives of those players within the peninsula. And some of it is undoubtedly down to the capacity within the group about whether or not they're able to reconcile some of this. But if I was to draw any analogies to what is in front of us in the current provisions within the bill, essentially we're kind of rehearsing the arguments whereby we've made a notification of those on those estates to produce a plan. It has fallen short of our expectations, and we have recently notified them of our intention to secure a control agreement, a voluntary control agreement. I went up to ASINT and chaired the meeting 2 weeks ago to kind of explain that process to all of the owners up there, not just the three that are owners of the designated sites, but some of the smaller estates as well, to explain what was in a Section 7 control agreement, the processes associated with it, and what we might like to see, because I think in our view the deer management group has proved to be largely dysfunctional. That notification wasn't met with open arms. You know, we have. It's been made quite clear that there are estates up there that are opposed to signing a Section 7 control agreement, and we have condensed the timescale within which we'd like to secure arrangements with them. So we're giving them a three-month time period. We're going to meet one-on-one with them to explain what we'd like to see, where we go, and what the risks are. And I suspect that we'll come back to the SNH board and indeed potentially the minister to take a view about whether or not we've got the appetite to regulate a system which involves two community-owned estates, two or three very small sporting estates, and an environmental NGO, because amongst themselves they haven't been able to work through this.
And therefore the powers of raising fines and things like that that this bill includes ought to be a message to these people out there to get their act together.
Well, that has been very firmly the message coming from SNH, that the risk that they run of not securing a voluntary agreement actually does bring us into Section 8 territory, and potentially significant financial penalties too.
Duncan, are you?
Yeah, just a wider comment. In the context of this bill, there is a land responsibility rights and responsibilities statement,
yes,
which very much focuses on who owns land. And actually, we would argue that there also needs to be a strong emphasis on how natural resources are used in the public interest as part of that statement. And that might help set the context for some of these disputes that occur, as Robbie says, across upland Scotland. We can't have a fencing solution for deer across much of upland Scotland.
Indeed, but without going into the detail of that.
Passing comment, just yep, so the committee are aware, I can't underestimate the strength of feeling and the significant breakdown in relationships between all of those estates up there that actually make sitting around the table and having a meaningful, mature conversation even more challenging than it is normally.
Thank you for that bit of evidence. And Sarah Boyack.
Just to come back to what powers SNH does have, and going back to your evidence, because one of the things you point out is that a control scheme can only remedy damage which has been caused. It can't seek to enhance a site. I was just wanted to ask the panel whether you think that's a deficiency in terms of the powers. You have to go through all this effort of getting people in a room and trying to get agreement, and what you're doing is remedying the past problem, but you're not necessarily getting a better solution that everybody would be able to sign up to and would benefit the area.
My observation on that is that the way the Deer Scotland Act is written, the regulatory impacts are to restore and restore damage, to prevent damage, and to it's not there to incentivise enhancement. That's why some of our other tools are about buying enhancement rather mm-hmm. than using regulation to potentially enhance habitats to a condition which they've never been before, which goes back to the earlier point about whether or not we've got the appetite to use Section 8 on the basis of a one-off visit, because to be honest, quite a lot of the condition of these designated sites at the point of designation, it doesn't provide us with a meaningful baseline on which we can demonstrate deterioration has occurred. So it does highlight the complexity, A, of the legislation, and B, trying to make meaningful assessments of ecological condition if we're going to use regulation to restore them.
And I suppose as a follow-up, you stressed the legislative requirement that deer have to be the primary cause of damage. but one or two of you have said, well, maybe if it's not the deer, there's other things as well. How do you get an integrated approach? Because deer management control orders might be a very effective way to get everyone around the table working together. How do you get those other issues dealt with when that's potentially what would actually give you a long-term solution of both addressing deer but also being able to bring an area up to scratch?
Yeah, I think we go into all of these negotiations very cognizant of the fact that domestic stock, as often as not, have got an integral role to play. Occasionally, we find the fact that it's those decisions about the balance between domestic stock and wild herbivores still remain within an estate's decision-making about where they consider the most appropriate balance to be between domestic stock and wild deer. But again, in the Ascent situation, if I can use that as an analogy, we've got 12 townships within the Ascent Crofting Trust property. We've got the Unipool Common Grazings, who are part owners of Cunyug that John Muir Trust owns. So when you introduce that additional complexity of domestic stock with wild deer, the negotiations do take more time, which is illustrative of the point where it's actually proving to be quite difficult to get a sensible solution.
Can I ask you, why don't you publicise the details of these agreements or even their existence on SNH websites?
I think we have done in the past, but certainly with the Deer Commission, all of those agreements were readily available, as was the count information, and there's certainly no reason why they shouldn't be. So we'll take that on board, Convener.
Thank you. Doug,
just a quick point. Back to the point about the balance and the decision between wild and domestic grazing. Of course, the other side to that are the policy signals and the drivers that come through things like CAP, and these, of course, will have an influence on people's stocking rates. And people, I think, as we've seen in the last year or so, are reacting quite strongly to that. And we've got areas where there's a lot more domestic grazers put back out into the hill than there were 2 years before. And in other areas, obviously, there's been reduction. So that's obviously a significant point too.
Okay. I think we should move on to deer management planning in the Lowlands for a change. Alec Ferguson.
Well, I think, yes, if we could come to what sounds like comparatively peaceful pastures of lowland deer management. There seems to be some dubiety over whether upland deer populations are increasing or decreasing, but I don't think there's any doubt at all that in lowland areas they are very much on the increase. Exploding might not be too strong a word. And of course we are different, pardon the pun, we are dealing with a very different beast in lowland deer management, quite literally, because we're dealing with very different species. One of the things that struck me from the meeting we had just last Monday was just how much, just over how much of lowland Scotland there is no recognised deer management. And it also was very well brought home that the bill has a sort of one-size-fits-all approach in that there is no specific recommendations for lowland Scotland as opposed to upland Scotland. And when you consider that in the lowland situation we are talking about deer management in and around heavily populated urban areas, as well as much more owner-occupied farms, that sort of situation. I just wonder how the panel feel. A lot of the submissions that you put in really asked how the government intended these measures to work in lowland situations, and I wondered if you would comment on how you think the bill as published would impact on lowland deer management.
So I should answer that first. And as you say, Alex, we did talk about this on Monday. I think the fact that there aren't deer management groups and we call them lowland deer groups to distinguish them from deer management groups, and that's quite an important distinction because, as you say, the only common ground between deer management in the highlands and lowlands, if one looks at it in a black and white sort of way, is that they share the word deer. I mean, different species, different habits, different geographical context and everything else. Since the Lowland Deer Network was formed in 2011, and its purpose was to introduce really a culture of collaboration in the lowlands, which exists over much of the highlands but has not previously existed in the lowlands, the number of lowland deer groups has increased from 6 to 10. So that is happening. But the absence of a deer group over much of lowland Scotland, and indeed each deer group only has partial cover of the area where it operates, so one actually has little formal collaboration, and it's not terribly formal even at its most formal, does not mean that deer management is not taking place at all. And there is a big appetite and considerable demand and in the sense of personal interest for deer management. And there are very few areas, I mean, I entirely accept what you say, that deer numbers are increasing very rapidly in the lowlands, and that is something that we should be concerned about, very concerned about, and that is why we're trying to develop mechanisms to deal with it. But there are a large number of individuals who are involved in deer management in the lowlands. Whether it's enough or not, we just don't know. We don't know what the population is. We have good evidence that it's increasing, evidence such as the increase in road traffic accidents, evidence such as the increase in economic damage to plantations and woodland, and indeed on agricultural land. What we're talking about here is a sector which is very much behind the red deer sector and has a great deal of distance to go to develop its potential capacity. But I would emphasize that deer management is going on. It's going on by people who are remarkably committed and skilled. I've been immensely impressed by that, by the individuals I've been dealing with, and I think we can make good progress with that. Applying the same sort of approach as we are in the uplands is not really workable. It's impossible to write a deer management plan that follows the model that we've designed with SNH for the highlands in the lowlands, and we've only just begun to talk and think about what a deer management plan or what deer management planning in the lowlands would look like. So I can't say very much about what it would look like other than a register of the ground covered, the people involved, their level of qualification, and a record of their culls. It would be difficult more than just to have a stock taking at this time and to have an action plan.
Could I ask for Robbie Cunningham's view on that same question?
And Angus?
Yeah, I'm...
And anybody else who wants to comment?
I think it is important to reflect on the very different context in which deer are managed in lowland Scotland, and certainly our previous considerations at this committee have been very red-centric and upland-focused, and it's important that we don't lose sight of the very real deer management challenges in lowland Scotland. I think the challenge for the lowland deer management is actually to try and ensure that we do get that kind of proactive and preventative approach before problems arise, because we've talked about Section 7 and we've talked about how SNH can respond to a problem, and we can do that in lowland Scotland, whether that's in relation to deer vehicle collisions or whether it's to do with particular issues of designated sites and forestry. But that is still quite a reactive approach. And whilst we did help set up the Lowland Deer Network Scotland, it was really to try and provide a bit of a bridge between those very skilled practitioners that Richard alluded to, who have got the appetite and the expertise to do a job and to manage deer effectively. But we tend to be struggling to get the owners of land and those people with the rights actually to start thinking proactively about deer management, because it doesn't really seem to be a big issue for them, whether they are local authorities, whether they're some of the big agricultural owner occupiers. Deer don't sit particularly high up their priority list. And I think the challenge is to match up actually the skills with the practitioners that we have got good engagement with and who have taken the time, energy and effort to set some of these lowland groups up with the resource. And that is a challenge for us. And legislatively, I don't think that there's anything we can do there, because it is about raising awareness of the need for deer management with those people that own land. And we have got mixed experience of trying to engage with local authorities on that basis, for example, who are big landowners and who do have a responsibility to proactively think about deer management in all the properties that they manage. And we've got very good examples of Dundee City Council or Aberdeenshire Council, and latterly Perth and Kinross, who are beginning to think about their position on deer management. But across the rest of the local authorities, it's just not top of their priority list, and that's something which we need to continue to tackle.
Graham Day wants to make a soft supplementary point.
Yeah, very much picking up on Robbie Kernaghan's point, and maybe for Richard Cooke. I mean, councils have responsibility for deer management handed them by the Wayne Act, didn't they? If, by and large, they're not exercising those responsibilities or taking the lead in that regard, what do we do?
Well, the Wayne Act makes it a duty of public bodies to manage deer sustainably and a responsibility of other land managers to do so. I think it's a very good question. Certainly SNH, backed up by LDNS, has done its best to bring representatives of local authorities into the same room to get them to understand that they have a responsibility and to consider how they might address it. I have to say, so far, we haven't been very successful, with one or two good exceptions.
That's concerning.
Oh, we'll make a note of that. So, Doug McAdam wanted to say something.
Thank you,
yes. Supplementary from Dave Thompson. Yes, sorry.
Yeah, thanks. I think in the Lowlands, I mean, large landowners down there can give a lead to this process, I think, and many of them will already have their own internal deer management plan in place. But I think one of the biggest challenges in the Lowlands is the huge numbers of people involved. We're talking a whole different nature, pattern of land ownership, lots of small, fragmented ownership across the area. And the big challenge is how you get that collaboration from such a large number of people.
Okay, Richard Cooke, and then we'll bring in Dave Thompson.
I did make the point on Monday that it may be that that a financial incentive will help people to collaborate, in particular bring farmers and possibly local authorities into the picture. And I referred, and it's still new territory, it isn't even available yet, to the Environmental Collaborative Action Fund, and to whether this might be available to Lowland deer groups. If so, it would be a strong incentive to form groups where individuals are already carrying out deer management and would promote collaboration, and that could be a step in the right direction, but it's untested, and I simply don't know whether a loose grouping such as a Lowland deer group would be likely to be able to put together a proposal, for example, for the creation of a larder. And I did mention on Monday the need for larder facilities in the Central Belt, for example. Now, whether that type of investment could be covered under the Environmental Collaborative Action Fund, but I think a financial incentive would be very much in the public interest.
Alec Hogg.
I'd just like to make a point about the game meat hygiene regulations from Europe. It doesn't allow an amateur deer stalker to take a beast into the butcher's with a jacket on. So therefore, he's got to take the jacket off in his shed and then take it to the butcher's shop, and which makes it illegal then. If we could tweak these game meat regulations, it would allow access to all local butchers and restaurants, a legal access to venison, which none of them can get at the minute. The way it works up north, the game dealers pick up massive amount of lots from estates, which is fine, but when you break it down into the wee lots of woodland and stuff in Central Belt, there's no way of getting it into the market. And if that was sorted, I think it would help massively with the deer control.
I think that's a way. I think we've got the kind of picture of that, Richard. You know, we'll make a note of that. In terms of the bill, obviously, there are things that go beyond the bill, and that perhaps is a business of development of the actual plans about how to do this. But, you know, at the present time, looking at the Lowland question, Dave Thompson as a supplementary.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener. And it was good to meet with Richard and his folk on Monday with the committee and the borders. And it's just really, as a point of clarification, I suppose, one of the leaflets we had on the table in front of us showed the area that LDNS covered. And a minute ago, Douglas said the Lowlands down there, but the leaflet actually showed the definition of the area you covered as a Lowland deer network, being what most folk would understand as the Lowlands down here, up the East Coast, right through Aberdeenshire, through Murray, taking in the Black Isle and parts of Easter Ross. Now, these are the Lowlands. But most folk, when they hear the word Lowlands, think Central Belt and round about that. So it was just really for clarity to get it on the record. Am I right in thinking this is what the Lowlands, when we're talking about the Lowlands in this context, that's what we're looking at right round the East Coast and even into Highland?
That is correct. I mean, there's significant overlap between the Highlands and the Lowlands, and if one relates it to the species, red deer are to be found in the Lowlands and roe deer are to be found in the Highlands. So it's by far from being a clear picture, but the map you referred to, which shows in orange the Lowlands in terms of their height above sea level, is correct. And there is, a very effective deer group in Banff and Buck, and the Banff and Buck and Lowland deer group, which is perhaps one of the best, actually, covers a very large area, certainly doesn't cover the whole of the area. There's nothing further north than that.
And your map did seem to show the Black Isle parts of Easter Ross as well, which intrigued me.
The map doesn't pretend to indicate where there are, whether it's collaborative management. It indicates the area where there needs to be collaborative management.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. Just on the basis of just to finish this bit section up unless Alex got another. No, 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 I'll make it afterwards, I think I don't want to interrupt.
Maybe the same point, Convenor, who knows? No, I mean, the obvious question to ask here is, you know, I hear there's progress being made, and I know there's moves to establish three different groups in southwest Scotland, in my part of Scotland, and so I hear there's progress being made, but the fact is we have a big increase in the population that is likely to continue. Mm. So is this approach, are we as a committee to assume that this approach is going to take care of the problem, or is there more we need to do to try to encourage a more rapid expansion and perhaps a more organised, because with the best will in the world, and I absolutely understand about the professionalism and the dedication of the voluntary people involved, I don't doubt that at all, but is it enough to rely on that to deal with what is going to become an even greater problem?
Things that need to be done, and they've already been alluded to. One is to get the local authorities to pay attention and to understand that they have responsibilities in this respect. And the other is, I have to say that although we have representatives on our group of the NFU, they are not really as responsive on that front as they should be. And of course, farmers are by a considerable on considerable scale the biggest landholders and land managers in the area. So they're active participation and involvement is important. We are a voluntary organisation. We do have some support from public funds. It's very difficult to make people cooperate who are not inclined to do so. So anything that can be done to encourage that and draw attention to it would be valuable. I've already alluded to the possibility of making some of the SRDP funds possibly available to support collaborative management mechanisms and projects they may want to do.
Mike Russell.
Yeah, I don't want to constantly appear to be a Jonah in these matters, but it seems to me that what we've just heard, exactly, Mr. Ferguson, but what we've just heard mirrors things that we have been hearing for years in other parts of Scotland in terms of how we tackle the problem. There is, you've just said, Mr. Cooke, you're a voluntary organisation. There's acceptance that there's no great unity amongst those involved. There's acceptance that some organisations and people don't want to be part of it or need to be reminded constantly of their duties, local authorities, and there's no accurate figure of what the problem is. Now, I could take you back to analysis of the situation in other parts of Scotland 10, 15, 20, 30, 40 years ago, and we would find exactly these issues being raised. So I don't doubt the will or the determination or the desire to have change. It seems to me you don't actually have the mechanism for change because you've still got all these same problems. They're just repeating themselves now in the south of Scotland. If you go on doing the same things, you get the same outcomes. I think this issue requires us to do different things, and therefore I think we need stronger statutory regulation. I go back to that point. And that alarms me, what we're hearing about the Lowlands, because it just repeats what we've heard about other places for a long time.
You had me in trouble before for putting words in your mouth, so I won't do that again. But what I would say is that if the Lowland Deer Network hadn't been set up under the voluntary principle, it was promoted and initiated by the ADMG because we aspire to manage deer throughout Scotland, then you wouldn't be hearing about the Lowlands at all, except where they cause problems up the highways and byways of Scotland. We're moving in the right direction. It's not good enough. It's not fast enough. I would have grave concerns that a statutory approach to this would have the greatest difficulties in designing one that would work.
When you hear about problems in terms of numbers of deer, and I'm not going to fall back into this issue of being described as being anti-deer because I'm not, but when you hear about these problems, very often people say, I wish we had acted earlier with more information, because what we thought the issue was, it turned out to be much worse. Now, it just seems to me, I'm not criticising the people who are doing good work, but I am saying the common elements in this are the same elements that were in place 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago in other parts of Scotland, and the problem kept getting worse. So we should learn from that, step back and say we need to do something entirely different to resolve this problem in the south. And I don't see what difference you could bring except a much stronger statutory framework that made real demands upon getting this problem solved. That's the difference of opinion between us, but I do think you learn from your mistakes. And if we just go on doing the same things, we won't learn from them.
Well, we're not. We're doing a lot more of the same things, and I think more of the same things is leading us quite firmly in the right direction, both in the Highlands and the Lowlands. But you do make an important point about information, and I should perhaps have said this in answer to Alex Ferguson's question, is that we're short of information when it comes to Lowland deer. Doing a count of the roe deer population is in practice impossible, and as Robbie may wish to comment on, what we really need to know is what's being culled and where it's being culled, and monitor the impacts of deer where they are. Now, we can't get information on what's being culled. SNH can collect data on culls where they know that culls are taking place, but they can only send out returns to people they know of, and that's a very partial picture. And I suspect it's within the power of government to join up some of the information gathering processes they've got. And I'm thinking in terms of the agricultural returns to get much more accurate and complete information on deer culls.
I'm not sure deer culls would necessarily tell you how many deer you have. It tells you how many deer have been shot, but it doesn't tell you how many deer there are.
Well, but the number of deer, as we've said on a number of occasions, is less important than the impact of them. So if you're using the cull as a proxy for what's taking place, and it is possible to extrapolate populations from culls, bearing in mind that you're cross-referencing with habitat impact and environmental impact and economic impact, then I think one can, the number of deer in itself is not a vital statistic.
Again, information from the past would suggest that if you try and extrapolate from culls to numbers, it's impossible. That simply does not work, because all you're doing is measuring effort and impact. You're not measuring numbers. You can't do it. So that, rather than reassure me, Mr. Cooke, I'm sorry to say you have added to my worries.
Well, I don't agree with you that using cull as a reference for population is inaccurate. Population modelling, as has been developed by SNH, is very valuable in relating the one to the other. But as I said earlier, the numbers are perhaps less important, and this has been said for decades. As long as I've been involved in the deer sector, the numbers are less important than the impacts. And if the impacts are negative, then management action is required to put them right.
Right, well, we're in a situation where we're dealing with this bill, which includes, just to remind you, a land commission. It might well be one of the things that finds us a priority to actually do, to find a way towards a solution about a method to deal with this matter. But before we come to Claudia's question, Robbie Kernahan on this point from SNH, and I have another supplementary just before we move to Claudia. So.
Okay, I'll try and make it brief, two or three things to build on that discussion. One of the other things which SNH has done since the committee last met and talked about deer management was to update and refresh Scotland's national approach to deer management. And it was envisaged that it would be a reasonably light touch revision, but after our discussions, I think, at committee last time, it was a bit more of a root and branch. So what it's tried to do over the next 5 years is really spell out where we consider the priorities to be. Collaborative planning and ensuring deer management groups up their game is certainly one of those priorities, but one of the others is actually on lowland and urban deer. There are challenges in there, as we've kind of alluded to, and I'm sure that some of the provisions within this bill won't do any harm, but I think we've all accepted that they won't necessarily resolve some of the issues which we've touched on. There are two things I wanted just to kind of highlight to the committee. One is there is no doubt in my mind there is a need to ensure that we raise awareness of the need for and benefits of effective deer management, and that is really about public perception. And I think some of the nervousness about local authorities actually is this still where some of this resides, the fact that having a discussion about whether or not to kill wild animals is a good thing or a bad thing still is quite a difficult thing for local authorities to reconcile. I think we've seen that through a number of kind of reasonably high profile casework. So there is a need to establish and raise awareness on that specific point. And the second point is actually, it does go back down to our understanding of what's happening of within the lowlands about roe deer management specifically. Of the 100,000 deer a year which we receive records for being culled in Scotland, that is based on returns from about 3,000 properties. There are 20,000 properties on the agricultural census, and I suspect most of them will be killing deer. So it does just highlight our lack of knowledge of what's happening in low ground Scotland, And the need, if we are actually going to tackle it, we do need to think about how best we ensure that we better understand some of those issues. So it is recognised within the government strategy for wild deer, and there are some pretty tricky issues for us to work through there.
Do you need to add to this, Doug, at the moment, or are you happy that we pass on?
It was just a very quick comment to say that, you know, a key part which LDNS is trying to address is this awareness. You know, we've got to remember that the people I was talking to in terms of fragmented ownership are farmers. Their principal job is farming, and they haven't up till this point possibly recognised that they have a responsibility for deer management on their ground.
Okay. Duncan, are you
in? I mean, I just add, I think, again, it would help as part of the land rights and responsibilities statement to make it clear that everybody has a responsibility for the sustainable use of natural resources, which include deer.
Okay. I'm going to come on to Claudia just in a second, but before we go, I'm just going to put it down as a question to you. There was some doubt raised by people about road accidents involving deer. I'm wondering if we've got any method to actually ascertain what the ballpark figures are, not just in terms of the deer deaths, but in terms of the effects on humans and their vehicles and so on. And if we can get that, it's not in the bill, but it's one of these factors which actually engages people in the Lowlands, just as it does in the Highlands, in a very big way. So I don't know whether Robbie Kernahan can help us, because there was a challenge to the figures that SNH provided us with in the committee, and I'd like to get an up-to-date picture on that.
Okay. I'm happy to talk to that in a bit more depth. I'm interested to know where the challenge has come from, because I wasn't aware of it. But, I mean, we have done a little bit of
letters
work
in the Scottish field, other places like that, you know.
We have
figures are wrong, far too high.
Spent a little bit of time over the last 5 or 10 years trying to better understand and quantify the scale and extent of the problem of deer vehicle collisions. With the best will in the world, using the data we have available to us, coming from a range of sources, Transport Scotland, local authorities, insurance companies, we have estimated, and it is an estimate, that there are between 7,000 and 10,000 accidents a year involving deer vehicle collisions. Going back to the point about where those are, and picking up on Dave's point about Lowland Deer Network, 70% of them are involving roe deer, not red deer. So it's the interaction between people and deer, rather than there being too many deer. It's about where we've got busy carriageways. We can break that down further into issues about how many of them result in significant personal injury and indeed fatalities. So those figures are there. I think we have a certain amount of confidence in that data, because it's been through a reasonably rigorous QA process. And we are encouraging Upland DMGs and others to be able to respond to some of those figures. Now, the solution is not straightforward, because we know it's about driver behaviour, about driver awareness, about speed, about roadside vegetation, about poorly positioned fencing, and indeed occasionally about deer numbers. So the solutions are complex. But one of the things I think it has highlighted is that these are the types of triggers where SNH can intervene using its powers to try and ensure that we can resolve those specific points in the country where there are hotspots. And we've done that in a number of ways in a number of different locations. It does illustrate to me that if we know there is a problem, we can respond to it. But it's not addressing the national perspective, as it were. It's still responding on a reactive basis.
We understand the situation. Thanks for the update just now. Doug McAdam, did you have anything you needed to add to that you were indicating?
No. Nope.
Right, fine. Claudia, move on, I think, please.
Right, thank you, Convener. Could I turn our minds to the penalty for not complying with a control system? Very briefly, Section 71 of the bill would increase the penalty with a Section 8 control scheme from £2,500 to up to £40,000. And the Scottish Government build team explained when they came before us that the rationale was that the current relatively low penalty for complying would mean that the landowner might simply, could choose to pay the fine rather than comply with the requirements. And do you accept that rationale, or are there any other comments about increasing the penalty?
Okay. Robbie Kernahan.
Yeah, I understand the rationale why SG have opted for that increase for refusing or willingly to comply with the control scheme. £40,000, it's a maximum fine comparable with other wildlife crimes, so I can understand why logically and consistently they want to have a fine of that nature comparable to other environmental crime. Mm-hmm. Compliance with a control scheme could bear potentially significant costs, so I understand entirely why SD have brought those provisions forward.
Okay. Doug?
I think a point that's worth making is that even before you get to the fine, SNH have the power to recoup all their costs of implementing measures that would be required. So I think to say that it's an incentive for people to perhaps take the fine rather to avoid the cost of management is not correct, because they will still have to bear the cost of implementation of these control orders, whether it's done by SNH, whoever. So, you know, with that in mind, that the cost will still be borne by the owner, you know, the fine is a substantial increase. And, you know, I would also challenge whether it's comparable to some of the environmental crime penalties that are there. When we look at the scale of maybe serious pollution incidents that are up at a league that might justify some of these fines, you know, this is perhaps not of that magnitude.
Okay, Alec.
Just a quick one. Does the fine apply to, if there's 9 owners who want deer and haven't got any, and one owner has shot all the deer, does the fine also apply the other way about?
Well, that's a question which we'll find out when we ask the government. Thank you for that. We will do. Jim Hume.
Yeah. Thanks very much. It's just regarding the deer panels. There's a section 69 is making a minor amendment to the 1996 Act on the role of deer panels, which are, of course, consultative panels which SNH can appoint either for advice at a very local level or at a national level. So just really interested in the panel, if they have any views, comments or any thoughts on implications of that amendment.
My observation is that, well, we have not used panels as often as we might have done, but part of the rationale for trying to ensure the localism agenda is sufficiently addressed and to think about perhaps using a panel to make sure that local community interests are sufficiently heard seems to me to be a sensible addition within the provisions of this bill.
Okay. Is anybody, any of the other members of the panel, any views or the content?
That's good. If you're content, that's fine by me.
Everybody nodded.
I would like to thank all of the members of the panel for what's been a very informative session for us. We will conclude this at the moment and have a five-minute, no longer than five-minute break. I now end.
Right now, thank you. We're moving on to the agenda item on Land Reform Scotland Bill continued. Oral evidence session on the second panel this morning, from whom we will hear evidence on part six of the bill on the entry and the valuation role of shooting and deer forests. And I welcome to the panel Douglas McAdam, once back to the panel, Chief Executive of SLE, Richard Cooke, Chair of the Association of Deer Management Groups again, Colin Shedden, Director of British Association for Shooting and Conservation. Good morning. Rupert Shaw, Vice Chair of NFU Scotland's Legal and Technical Committee, NFUS. Good morning. And Alistair McTaggart, President of Scottish Assessors Association. Good morning. And Bruce Cooper, the Angus Glen Moorland Group. Good morning. I'd like to kick off with right at the heart of this issue, which is the panel's views, and if you just indicate you're going to reply to this, are you clear about the policy objectives of this part of the bill? Do you agree with the justification for ending the exemption for shootings in deer forests, but continuing to exempt some other rural businesses such as agriculture? So a two-part question. Anybody who wants to start? Doug McCallum.
I'll kick off then. I think the first answer is no. What I did note was in evidence from Scottish Government to this committee, civil servants said that the exemptions were being retained for agriculture and forestry because they were sustainable and in line with government policy priorities for agriculture and forestry. Now, in our view, given that the exercising of sporting rights, shooting and deer forests are essentially about sustainable harvest of a natural resource, but also in the process of doing that, they deliver a whole range of other public benefits, such as deer management, which we talked about earlier, vermin control, biodiversity and conservation, rural employment, food production, landscape management, wildfire management, investment into local businesses. I could go on. Now, I would have considered that those areas that I have just outlined are absolutely in line with government policy. And indeed, the other day, Fergus-Ewing, Minister for Business, Tourism and Energy, came to launch a bit of research which was actually talking about such socio-economic benefits and community attitudes to that, and he wholeheartedly put his backing and the Scottish Government's backing behind what shooting and shooting sports deliver for Scotland. So I would have said that everything that that's delivering is slap bang in government policy priorities, so I'm slightly perplexed as to why they would be treated differently to other land uses.
Well, we'll explore that. Who else wants to come in? Rupert Shaw? It's all right, it's dealt with automatically. If you just point the microphone at yourself, that would be fine.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Well, we are absolutely opposed to this, and I'm very glad I've just witnessed the previous section. It seems to me, as a farmer member of the union, that risk and responsibility for managing the wild resource is about to be transferred to us at cost, and then we're also potentially to pay rate on this activity. It seems to me that this proposition doesn't suit those 17,600 agricultural holdings we talked about, many of which are in many terms on the floor at the moment in terms of price of commodities and the rest of it. And we have a real challenge in terms of educating our membership as to what are shootings. Throughout the south of Scotland, where I am, shootings are not managed commercially. Many shootings are, in fact, casual affairs in my own area. They're dominated by the scallop boatmen, many of whom will come on to those cops and whinnies and wins on dairy farms and casually take the opportunity for a country pursuit. And I feel there's a real risk here that for many land holdings, under pressure by bringing in a rateable and a legislative requirement on them to register as shootings, in fact, that opportunity to exercise sport by many will be withdrawn, and shootings will become, in fact, focused on those larger land holdings where it is already a commercial activity. So we're quite firmly against the proposal.
Yeah, thank you. We heard the NFUS's proposals. What about Colin Shedden?
Yes, I'd like to make a couple of fundamental points on this. We have produced evidence in the past that has demonstrated that shooting and deer stalking is worth something like £200 million to Scotland. And maybe some people have looked at that and thought that's quite an attractive target to tax. The unfortunate thing is when you delve down and look at the detail, you find that 88% of these businesses are actually run at a loss or break even. So very few are actually profitable because they don't follow a profit-making model. And I was pleased to see that Scottish Land and Estates produced some evidence recently that demonstrated 90% in your survey, again, were showing that these businesses were not run as profitable businesses. And Doug demonstrated quite clearly that there is a lot of wider benefit to the environment and society from these shooting businesses. So we feel that it's unfair to look at these businesses as other businesses that are based on profit-making models, because they clearly are not. Thank you.
Okay, but the balance of these things we have to discuss. That's what we're here for. Richard Cooke.
Convener, simply to say that we also oppose the removal of the exemption for sporting rights on the grounds that have already been said. I don't want to repeat what's been said, but as I said in the last session, deer management needs people. An extra cost imposed against deer management is likely to attack the major cost of deer management, which is employment. And so I'd be very concerned about the implications for employment and the infrastructure that's necessary to continue deer management across the country with this additional cost. Should it be introduced?
Do you want to say something, yes? Alistair McTaggart.
Good morning. Just to say that the assessors obviously have no opinion on whether the tax should be imposed or not. That's a matter for the Parliament to decide and for the legislator to decide what the exact wording of the legislation should be. Our role is simply to apply that tax if and when it is actually legislated for, and in the meantime to advise the Parliament and its officials in terms of the preparation towards that.
Angus MacDonald.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just following on from the general comments that we've heard so far, panel members may or may not be aware that the Scottish Wildlife Trust has put forward a proposal that a revised rate on deer shooting could, for example, be based on the level of deer cull required to protect public interests, and then only be charged when an owner or occupier was not achieving the adequate culls. How would the panel members feel if that proposal was worked on and brought forward?
Bruce Cooper, did you want to say anything about those questions?
I had nothing new to say. I think it was all said before me, but I think it's hugely important to consider where the money's going to come from. Because I, as a manager working on a Highland estate, I know fine that we don't make a profit, and any other taxation on that may affect our ability to employ.
Okay. Thank you. Richard Cooke, then Rupert Shaw, then
thank you. I'm delighted that the Scottish Wildlife Trust have made that suggestion, because we made it ourselves. If I could just read from the relevant paragraph of our submission. We would therefore propose that relief should be available for sporting rights which are managed in a way which meet relevant public interest criteria. For example, a landholding which participates in a deer management group for which there is an effective deer management plan endorsed by the Scottish Natural Heritage might qualify for relief. This would have the effect of promoting collaboration, furthering the public interest, and strengthening the voluntary approach to deer management. So I just wanted to say that I think is a very constructive way of turning what could be a penalty into an incentive to sustainable deer management.
So, Rupert.
Thank you. Well, if I quote what I heard in the earlier session about red-centric, upland-focused legislation, I feel there's a danger here as well. What are we doing to
educate? We looked at the whole gamut of deer in the last session. You know, let's be clear about that. I wouldn't want to introduce the witnesses from the last one, and we heard all about the rest of Scotland. If you were there, I hope you did too.
I did, absolutely, but I live in a part of Scotland where there is no deer management group at moment. So to hear the refrain that bringing in a rateable activity to incentivise to take part in something that has not yet been constructed in many areas, is not yet fully established, seems odd at this stage.
Okay, thank you. Doug?
Yeah, whilst I wouldn't necessarily agree with the detail of what Scottish Wildlife Trust have suggested, the principle of reliefs and reliefs for demonstration of good management, I think, is a very good one. And indeed, we've mentioned that in our own submission too. I would agree with Richard in terms of functioning deer management groups and deer management plans as a basis for such relief. But also, I would commend the Wildlife Estate Scotland initiative. We've now over 30 estates accredited across Scotland, which provides a demonstrable way of showing your delivery for wildlife and for biodiversity in an independently accredited fashion. So if we were to go down that route, I think that would provide a very good basis for a relief that's going to incentivise the right sort of management.
Thank you. Mike Russell, and then Sarah Boyer.
Yes, I think, like it or not, and most people don't like to be taxed, in fact, I would say everybody doesn't like to be taxed, this is likely to happen, given the proposal in the bill. I think what we should focus down on is the accuracy of the measure, the definition of what is being taxed, so that it does at least the minimum harm possible and perhaps some good. Could I ask you to comment on three possibilities within this? We've heard the Wildlife Trust one. I think what I've heard generally in discussion of this over the last few months is this, that deer management, effective deer management, should not be taxed, because effective deer management is essential for a variety of reasons, including environmental reasons. That there should be the utmost care about taxing small and medium-sized enterprises, and particularly tourism, if they are price-sensitive. Now, I haven't seen any evidence of price sensitivity at all, but equally, there's an absence of evidence, but that doesn't prove it's not there. So we would need to see evidence of price sensitivity. But we should tax large-scale recreational activity. One of the reasons for that is that the removal in 1995, if it was a real disincentive to those people, the removal should have created additional economic activity in the countryside. There is absolutely no evidence that happened from 1995 onwards. In fact, quite the reverse is true. So there's no evidence of a disincentive in those circumstances. So if we were to make those distinctions, perhaps the panel could suggest how they might be applied and other distinctions that might be made.
Colin.
On the final point, when you talk about large-scale recreational activity, I imagine you're talking about large, relatively intensive, driven game bird shoots.
On large estates.
And on large estates. What would concern me would be that if these were being taxed, and they may currently be making just a small profit, they may feel to remain profitable that they need to intensify even further. And I think most of us would agree that whether it's grouse shooting, pheasant shooting, partridge shooting, the level that takes place in Scotland is not at the same intensity as in some other parts of the UK, and we wouldn't probably want to move in that direction. It would worry me if a tax drove people to intensify their game management rather than de-intensify it.
Could you be positive about other exemptions? I mean, if this is likely to happen, and it is likely to happen, trying to find the right way to apply it, the accurate way to apply it is what I'm trying to get at. So are there positives that you could think of?
Yes, certainly. I would support Doug's comment relating to Wildlife Estate Scotland, Richard relating to effective and sustainable deer management all being exempt. My concern would be probably for the assessors, because they would be in the invidious position of having to actually, first of all, determine which properties have to be included and then which properties have to be exempt. And I think there's going to be an awful lot of work for them in the next couple of years to bring in all the properties concerned, and then an even greater burden of work to determine which ones have to be exempt or to benefit from relief. So it starts to make it a very, very complex situation, a complex problem for them in an area where maximum revenue could be £4 million.
The timescale for this will be determined by secondary legislation. So there isn't necessarily a time limit on which it might go forward. I see various people want to come in. So, Alec Ferguson first.
Well, it's just a brief point, Convener, and thank you for bringing me in. I always try to agree with Mike Russell where possible, but it isn't always possible in my in my own position. And he's just said that he, in his view, since the rates were taken away in the mid-90s, he believes there's been a great decrease in sporting activity, if I can put it that way. I think in my experience, I would say the opposite.
Rural employment.
I beg your pardon. Rural in that case, I will shut up.
You see, we can agree.
I'm glad they're agreeing again. Right, very good.
Peace is broken out.
Rupert and then Sarah.
Thank you. A challenge for the union in getting a position in relation to this proposal was not having sight of some of this detail, which you're now touching on. And this is the key issue. I think for many smaller land holders, you know, there is a real fear. If I have a couple of winds that row harbour up in overnight, does this mean I'm now liable for an additional tax? I think we need to, you know, we really need to have unpicked before we proceed with this in a legislative way, actually what shootings could mean. What is an assessor's take on that small family farm that happens to have a clump of trees with roe deer in?
Those were never in the valuation rule prior to 1995. So as the legislation simply seeks to remove the 1995 exemption, I think it is safe to assume, and the legislation doesn't do anything against that, it's safe to assume that it's talking in the same definition. I asked about definitions the last meeting. Assuming that, can you be just a little bit more positive about some exemptions?
Well, I think the fear remains when it's an assessor's view of sporting potential. You may not have looked as a non-field sports at a dairy farmer, for example, that you're holding as a sporting opportunity. And I think, like so much, we need a process of consultation and education for those many landholders, farmers, etc., who are currently outside of the field sports sort of game cover sort of activity, to understand, are they now going to become liable for a rating?
Doug McAdam, then Sarah Boyer.
Yes, I think it's worth, I hope, making the point. Mr. Russell, I disagree with your assessment there. Our understanding is that if the exemption is removed, we go back to the original Valuation Acts, which actually says that, because what we're actually valuing here is the sporting right, which is shootings and deer forests, and that applies to virtually every non-urban acre across Scotland where a sporting right exists. So it does apply, in our view, to small farms. It applies to the small field outside Falkirk, where someone's now paying 100 quid to shoot rabbits. It applies right across the range. And so the 8,000 entries that were on the valuation roll before were actually, you know, not doing the job.
I don't think anybody in this room or in the Parliament, expects it to be applied to a field outside Falkirk with 100 rabbits.
That's what the legislation says.
No, I don't think it does. I think it's quite clear Section 66, 1, 2, and 3, and 67, 1, 2 have no such intention. And with the greatest respect, Douglas, I don't think that helps the debate. The debate is, should there be a reimposition, and what exemptions should apply? Certainly, I wouldn't support the imposition of sporting rates on a field outside Falkirk with 100 rabbits. I wouldn't support it for the dairy farmer that had one shoot a year. There are businesses which are going to be taxed. I think that's likely to happen. We need a sensible discussion about how how that matter goes forward. And I don't really think fields outside Falkirk, Douglas, with the greatest respect, help that sensible discussion.
Well, just a minute. I know that Sarah's been very, very patient here. The member from Falkirk East agrees. There is no such field. Okay. There are more rabbits than that, yes. Okay, I think we've got to try and focus this a bit. And Sarah Boyack perhaps can.
I had a brief supplementary in following up from this discussion, and it was really to ask the assessors, I think. We've heard from a few people about not-for-profit businesses, and just wondering how not-for-profit businesses would fit into the small business bonus scheme. Have you thought about all those issues?
I'm not sure if that's talking about the same thing there. In what the assessors do, we value a right or an occupation of property, and whether that occupation is financially viable or not is largely of little importance, because we are valuing a hypothetical tenancy. If there are difficulties in terms of being able to meet rates bills or the ultimate rates bill, then that's a matter between the ratepayer and the Director of Finance in terms of ability to pay and any relief that might be available.
Misunderstood my question. It's not about your ability to pay. It's about a threshold that there is, that if your business is below a certain level, you are exempted automatically.
Well,
just trying to tease out what research we've got as to how many businesses would fit into those categories.
I don't think there's anything in legislation that said that below that level of value there'd be no entry in the valuation role. Hypothetically, every shooting right, as Doug said, should be in the valuation role. I think what has happened over 100 years leading up to 1995 is that a degree of a pragmatism came in to say that these are the valuable shootings, these are the shootings where the right is exercised and there is some value in that right, and these are the ones that are entered in the valuation role. I think we now have to re-establish that position. That's what assessors have to do in the next 2 to 3 years to analyse the nature of the landscape, if we can call it that, and see what exactly is there that can be valued and how it's valued.
Rupert, yeah, and then
I mean, if I may, based on what Alistair's just said, I think that confirms our concern that this has the potential for unforeseen circumstances, which may, of course, by the nature of those holdings, impact the poorest in the most remote areas of Scotland.
Well, we're talking about various thresholds and so on in the small business bonus, which Sarah has just sort of talked about, and we're just saying to you these could be applied in terms of sporting rights. And therefore, this is a question which is live and which we will ask ministers about. What the impression of assessors are and so on will be determined by what the secondary legislation comes out with. But on the back of that, we've got agreement that the idea of exemptions for good behaviour, shall we put it that way, might be a way forward. Rupert, and you?
Well,
and then Richard, yeah.
It's just to reinforce, if I may, this business of unforeseen circumstances. I think an assessor's view of the potential of a holding, may impact some of our poorest and smallest farms in the most fragile and remote areas of Scotland. This, I'm sure, is not the intent of this bill in terms of bringing in another tax burden.
Okay. I think we're on parallel lines here. We're talking about small business bonus for low-income businesses. So the potential in DEAR is about looking at the impact on that small business of that, which is what Sarah's been asking about.
With respect, surely this isn't just about DEAR, it's about shootings as well. And that takes the thing into a completely different realm, because I can absolutely see what we're talking about working in relation to DEAR management. I have real difficulty in seeing how it works in the sort of small farm shoot. And I just leave that on the table for now. No, it's not simple. No.
Okay, Angus MacDonald.
Yeah, thanks. Just picking up on Alistair MacTaggart's point, can you give us some assurance that there is a capacity for assessors to go out and speak to the sector? we have heard that in order to meet the statutory duties, all sporting rights should be valued and entered onto roll, regardless of whether the right is exercised. So I'm just curious as to whether you feel that the rights would have a nil value should the sporting rights not be utilised.
That's certainly a possibility. I think the first stage that we have to go through is to establish who occupies, who are the proprietors, tenants and occupiers of the various shooting rights that exist across Scotland. So that's the first and immediate task we face. That's quite a significant task, given that the source of that information or the sources of that information may be wide and varied, and we have a fair degree of research to go through to establish that position. Thankfully, we've already had, or my colleagues have had, meetings with representatives of certainly the the gentleman here to my left, the meetings have taken place as recently as last Thursday, and we have made some very good progress thus far in terms of how we go about our business over the next couple of years. There is one line in the proposed legislation that may be of assistance, and that is in the reintroduction of the Section 1A of the 1888. It's the Act of 1888, which says that these will be entered in so far as exercisable. So that there may be shooting rights out there that cannot be exercised, and in that case, then there's provision there that such a right might not need to enter the valuation roll. That, how many that may be, is something we need to discover. The other point to make is that assessors don't make value. Assessors follow the value that others make. The value that the assessors apply in the valuation roll is our assessment of annual value or net annual value, which is the rent that passes for the property. To establish that, we look at what is actually paid by way of rent between landlords and tenants, in this case of shooting rights, and we will analyse that to come up with what we think is a fair and reasonable level of value for various subjects in various parts of the country. Again, it will be the assessor's opinion of that, but that opinion can be challenged, and challenged as far as the courts if we can't reach agreement on that value.
Richard Cooke, yeah.
On the subject of the small business bonus scheme, more a question than a statement. Am I not right in thinking that this has a different standing in statute than the bill, and is separate from the bill? Is there any guarantee that the small business bonus scheme will continue to be applied in future out with this statute? Because if not, this discussion is to some extent hypothetical.
Yes. Okay, we take your point. I should just slightly correct myself from what I said earlier about there won't be secondary legislation, because it says quite clearly that the government's intention is for the proposed change to take effect at the next revaluation on the 1st of April 2017, when properties are valued as at the 1st of April 2015, the tone date. So, in fact, there won't be any secondary legislation, but the discussion about the small business bonus is germane to us and our report, and therefore it is relevant to see means to encourage people to do things well.
Although the date is to be introduced as the 1st of April 2017, i.e. that is being brought back into the rating system with effect from the date of the next revaluation, there are already provisions whereby the assessor can introduce that value at any time up until the 31st of March 2018. The existing legislation allows, where the information is not fully complete or the analysis is not concluded, that value can be introduced retrospectively up until the 31st of March 2018.
Okay. Colin Shedden.
Can I just ask a question relating to the term exercisability? Because my understanding...
Well, wait a minute. We can't continue to cross-question each other
across
the panel.
It was raised, and it's just that my understanding, my recollection was that pre-1995, the owners of land that had a sporting potential were taxed, whether they used it or not. Exercisability probably related to inaccessibility of land or some other physical barrier that prevented the shooting rights being undertaken.
Whatever.
But the important point is that pre-95, if you owned land and chose not to exercise the shooting rights, you were still taxed on that rateable value.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. Doug McAdam.
I think it might be, we did actually cover this in the meeting with the assessors that we had last week, so it might be a useful point of clarification. And we discussed this very issue, and what it was in an era where physically the rights couldn't be exercised, and we asked for an example, and for instance it would be maybe an old glebe land that was still inside a village, so there were actually physical barriers to actually exercising the right. But everything else where a sporting right exists would have to be identified, surveyed, valued, put on the roll.
Okay, well, we'll ask the ministers about that. Richard Cooke.
I'm concerned about what Alice referred to earlier as the pragmatic approach, if it's to be reapplied as it was in the past, and the point that Mike Russell was making about scale. I can think of a situation where a deer management group may have a number of members who take, say, 100 stags and 200 hinds annually, and other members who may take one stag and two hinds annually. If one is going to be exempt because it's small, then that's quite inequitable in terms of the neighbouring estates who share access to the same deer population.
We're hearing what you're saying just now. Okay, that's questions that we will ask. That's our job to do, and thank you for your points. We have to move on to about the expected take by the tax. Jim.
Thank you very much, Convener. A couple of strands to this question. One is the accuracy of the Scottish Government's estimate. That estimate is that they would get a gross revenue of around £4 million. They seem to be basically justifying that by looking at what was brought in 1994, which was about £2 million, and doubling that because non-domestic rates have doubled since then. But, of course, in my simple view, non-domestic rates are relating to property values, which shooting rates aren't. So I wondered what the panel's views were on the accuracy. And, of course, then again, we have to look at what net revenue would be. Do we think it would be actually cost-effective to gather in these rates, bearing in mind the small business scheme which we've talked about, but also, of course, extra staff that maybe have to be taken on by local authorities, etc., etc.? Thanks.
Yes, Douglas, McAdam, then I think Bruce Cooper, then Alistair.
Firstly, as to the accuracy of the £4 million figure, well, it's obviously a guess in the dark. It's based on what was on the roll before, and I think as we've already covered in ground in this session, what was on the roll before isn't what would be on the roll in future, and what percentage of that is liable to reliefs, we don't know. And I think to me this goes to the heart of the matter, which is that we can't put a proper figure on this because there hasn't been a full analysis. There hasn't been the due diligence of an economic impact assessment done. And part of that is because the mechanism hasn't been clarified how it's to be done. Now, surely there should be steps for a process like this that are gone through, which is generally referred to as a due diligence, so that we all understand what this looks like and can make informed decisions. And I just don't think that's been done. So, hence, I would say, yeah, the figure isn't accurate. Yeah. We've no way of knowing.
Bruce Cooper.
Well, I would just like to ask, you know, how this expected take of £4 million is going to encourage the landowners to employ, to keep these small and fragile communities alive. Because, you know, there isn't a profit, and these rural communities need to be invested into heavily to survive as they are just now.
Just now, yes, indeed. Alistair McTaggart.
Well, I think in terms of the estimate, I wouldn't like to speculate as to whether the increase would be 4 million, 6 million or 2 million. That's something that needs to be established, having looked at all of the evidence. Just to point a couple of matters out which may affect individual views of the estimate is that the value in 1995, or the values imposed when the tax, or that part of the rating system, was removed in 1995, were actually 1988 levels of value. That was the tone level set for the 1990 revaluation. So these values are today 27 years old. So that, from that starting point, I think the assessors in our response to the consultation stated that there are a number of factors will have affect value in that interim. Including these are the removal of a tax may have made more money available for rent, so the landlord may take a large proportion of available income by way of rent. There's been a significant change in the legislative background. We heard much of that this morning, but we've had the Deer Scotland Act 1996, firearms legislation, food hygiene legislation, and a number of other acts all affect the use that can be made of land, so that will impact on rents and therefore rateable values. And of course the economics of the rural landscape have changed. We now have large tracts of the upper lands covered with wind farms. How does that impact on shooting rights and the value of shooting rights? So these are all matters that we need to examine to see if they impact, and if they do impact, by what amount. So
Jim?
Just a question following on for to Alison McTaggart, who's obviously president of the Scottish Assessors Association. This would take some man and woman power from assessors, so surely the, your association will have had some estimate of how many man and woman hours this work would take and be able to inform us slightly better about what sort of implications that would have financially.
Yes, I think our original estimate was based on the fact that we might be putting, or based on the assumption that we're putting back in what was there in 1995, which I think, if it was, if I can remember the figures, was it was it was something like 2% of the total number of subjects in the valuation role. But as has been mentioned earlier, if we are to consider every possible entry that may be made, which is down to from the largest estate to the smallest croft in Scotland, then we may be looking at 52,000 to 55,000 additional properties where we'll have to consider whether an entry is to be made. The point I would make is that these are largely in the areas covered by assessors, which have smaller numbers of non-domestic properties, and the amount of staff and expertise that are in these offices today as compared to 1995 is much changed, and in terms of staffing levels is reduced. So there is a more significant task for perhaps, say, the assessor for Scottish Borders than there is for me in Renfrewshire. And that's something we've been discussing with the Scottish Government officials as to as to how we deal with that. Our plan is that the values will be in place by 2017, provided we can get the response to the information requests that we put out. Assessors rely almost entirely on information that we gather through the rights that assessors have to obtain information under the Valuation Act. And if we get that information and we work collaboratively with the industry, I'm sure we will manage that. But I think it does take it will take cooperation to get where we need to be by the date of the revaluation.
Okay. Sarah Boyack, following up on this just now. Okay.
Thank you very much, Convener. I suppose I have one other question that has occurred to me, having listened to the last exchanges, which is whether we know the impact on revenue intake on income tax, national insurance, VAT, when the rates were last abolished, whether we've got a marker of what impact that actually had, to what extent there were any jobs created. I think it'd be quite useful for us to pin that down. So I'm not going to ask anyone unless they instantly have that in their back pocket, but I think we as a committee, it would be good for us to look at. The second question I wanted to ask is a comment that's been made by the Chartered Surveyors that they believe that a review or economic analysis was needed before implementation of the proposal was made, and they believe that without that, this part should be removed from the bill. So I was wondering what the comments were from the panel on that submission from RICS.
Doug.
As I said, I think at the outset I would totally support that. I think we're all, if you pardon the expression, we're all shooting in the dark a bit here, and to make informed decisions we need that due diligence.
Colin?
I would also add that the business regulatory impact assessment was rather weak in this area, in our view.
Okay. Any other responses to that? No? Okay.
We can look at. Yes. Might be one thing we want to actually specifically examine, given the evidence we've had from across the panel this morning ourselves.
Yeah. Okay. I think we've dealt with the issue about exemptions and so on. Did you have any points to make, Claudia?
Just very briefly, yes. Convener, just to follow up in case there was any other comment, particularly from yourself, Alistair, about, you've touched on borders already. As a local authority, I believe, but how much extra work ending the exemption might mean for local authorities more generally, and whether they would have the capacity to deal with the extra work in the time available?
Yes, I think that there's two components to that. There's firstly the work that the assessors will have to do, which is the valuation work, and then there's the work that the Director's Finance will have to do, which is the gathering of the tax, or the collection of the tax. I think that perhaps the greater part of that will be in establishing the values. The billing mechanism is fairly well established, and it's just a small addition to that. The harder part is establishing who should be entered in the valuation role and at what level of value. That's going to take some time. And I think in terms of the cost of doing that, we have mentioned this in discussions with the Scottish Government officials, and I think it has also been raised with COSLA, and COSLA have taken this on board, and when discussions are had in setting budgets or budget levels, I think hopefully this will be taken into account in those areas where there's a significant additional impact on workload.
Mm-hmm. Right, thank you.
A point, if I can, on valuations. I think this is an absolutely crucial part of this. In the previous system, the way the valuation was undertaken ended up with a system that was roughly based on bag data to get to a unit value to be able to come up with the hypothesis of the hypothetical tenant to get to the value. And as we know, that resulted in the mass appeals that were going on at the time. It moved further and further away from reality, and we ended up in a situation with mass appeals because obviously the values are being challenged, and you know, we don't want to end up in that same position. No one does.
Okay. Alistair.
Perhaps just to make it clear, although we talk about a rate per bag or a rate per number of animals taken, that's not what we are doing. What we are valuing is our estimate of the net annual value, which is the rent. That will then, once we've done that, and we do this with all properties, we will work that back into something that's readily recognisable in terms of being able to do a comparison with shops. It's a rate per square metre, with public houses, it's the turnover, with cinemas, it's the number of seats, and with shootings, it's the bag. It could equally be a rate per hectare. It's just a mechanism we use to enable us to draw comparisons. And if we don't agree, then the right of appeal is always there. And 90% of appeals are settled amicably.
Well, we are looking at different forms of local taxation and the tax commission separately from this particular bill. So these issues are going to be very germane, because there will be a very different way of assessing certain local taxes in future, which the assessors will have to do as well. So these things are not to be seen in isolation. Want to move on to Graham Day now.
Thank you, Convener. I want to explore whether the ending of the exemption is consistent with sustainable deer management and land management objectives. Would there, for example, be a potential negative impact on biodiversity?
Richard Cooke.
Potentially, yes. If the, as referring to previous remarks, if the effect of reintroducing rates adds cost to deer management, the likely casualty is likely to be employment, and which means less ability within the system to control deer numbers and prevent negative environmental impact. So, undoubtedly, yes.
Colin Chen.
On the biodiversity front, the independent work that we were involved with demonstrated that shooters in Scotland spend the equivalent of £35 million in conservation activity each year. And that's very wide-ranging conservation activity, from pest predator control, land management, habitat creation, feeding pheasants, feeding duck ponds. All of these things fall into the category. And it is very important, and it's very concerning that if this was to affect the viability of shoots, it would affect the viability of that conservation management that takes place as well.
Douglas McAdam and then Rupert Shaw.
Thanks. Yeah, I mean, I think it's basic. If you increase the cost of operation for any operation, it's going to have a negative impact. So in this case, it is going to have an impact on biodiversity, as we've said in our evidence. About £35 million a year is invested into conservation management as a result of the exercising of shooting rights across Scotland. Provides 3,500 full-time equivalent jobs. There's obviously be consequences, but I think it also comes back to the process of valuation. And if bag data and these sort of things are used, you can end up producing some pretty perverse outcomes where people might, for instance, end up shooting less deer, which would increase biodiversity impacts. So this needs a lot of thought, obviously, so we don't get perverse outcomes.
And Rupert Shaw.
Yeah, if I may, to echo some of that in relation to the conflict, farmers are being asked under the current cap reforms to pay attention to greening, to have greater wildlife margins, to have areas that have an ecological focus on their holding. if a land manager or farmer undertakes all of that activity and is then told, right, now you've created something that is rateable, where's the focus? Is it in on increasing that biodiversity or getting people in to deal with what is now harboured there?
Bruce Cooper.
Yeah, as well, just, you know, it's the boots on the ground, it's the rabbits, it's the moles, it's the deer causing erosion. And if you remove the men that are doing the job, then it will have a dire effect on the landscape.
Graham Day.
But you wouldn't abandon doing that. Your ability and your capacity to do it, the extent to which you could do it, might be diminished very slightly if you had, say, one less gamekeeper. But in reality, you would still carry out, in the main, the same tasks.
I think the more gamekeepers that are on the ground, the more likelihood there is that these tasks are carried out to the level that they should be. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, a blind man could probably see the increase in mole numbers in these rural communities over the last few years, and that's just purely through a change of legislation. So, you know, you definitely need the workers on the ground and you need to encourage these workers to be on the ground. And the only way to do that is to encourage the landowners to employ.
Okay. Dave Thompson, briefly, please.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. It's just a quick follow-up. Not directed to anybody in particular, but I'm intrigued at a number of the statements that were made about not following a profit-making model in relation to some of these shootings, which probably wouldn't relate to the farmers' ones, but maybe some of the bigger estates. If the model is not profit-making and we wanted to encourage folk to improve the environment, then stop running the model that doesn't make profit, that actually loses money, and use that money to actually employ people to do the jobs that Bruce was mentioning in looking after the environmental issues. Is that logical or is that daft?
Well,
Bruce, yeah.
I say it's very, very difficult because, believe you me, we try to make a profit, but it's very, very difficult to make a profit with what you have available to you. This season, for instance, very bad weather, our income from driven grouse shooting has been cut by 75%. Now, the landowner doesn't want to pay off his six keepers. He just hopes that the weather's a bit better next year and that he can't possibly narrow that margin down a bit. The deer management side of it, it's very difficult because it's such an expense to run. You need the gamekeeper, the ghillie, the Land Rover, the Argo carts. So it's a very, very difficult environment to make a profit into it, and we're just trying to do the best we can.
Maybe if I could just come back quickly on that, Convener. Yeah, I accept what you're saying, but the logic of that is that if they stopped doing those things, they would save money. And if a landowner wants an estate with a nice environment, then it would surely make sense to stop doing things that aren't effective and is costing them money and use the money to actually improve the environment more generally, still employing six people, maybe even more. You understand the logic where I'm coming from. If it's so difficult to make that profit, stop doing it, use the money for better things to improve the environment in which the landowner can live and others can also enjoy.
But what is that other thing, actually? Because I think a lot of other things have been explored. I mean, we've put a hydro system into our glen, a burn flow hydro system, to help generate some income. But what else do you actually do?
You could employ more gamekeepers to keep the moles down, to keep the rabbits down, to generally improve things. You were on about erosion, you know. The point I'm trying to get at is, why are people wasting their money on a non-profitable exercise?
I don't think they're wasting their money, because when it is good, it can be money-making. But, you know,
a lot of the comments that I think we heard earlier, that the model was non-profit-making, were incorrect.
I think the aim is always to make a profit, but it's very difficult to do so. But finding an alternative to make the profit and keep the men on the ground would be extremely difficult.
We're not going to go further with this particular line of argument. I'm sure that everybody would love to talk about what's profitable, good and bad and all the rest of it, but that wasn't the question in the first place. I think we can leave that
hanging in the air, which we can follow up, because I think Dave has made a point which we need to explore with the ministers. And we need to move to Mike Russell's part of this question just now, time being as it is.
There would be people observing this from another universe, shall we say, who arriving here by rocket and sitting through this meeting might sort of define what we've heard so far in this session by people who say that they own lots of land, they don't make any money from it, sorry to go back to Dave's point, but they don't make any money from it, but then saying to a government, if you dare to tax us in the same way as we tax other people, we'll lay off staff. Would that be a fair representation of where we find ourselves at this moment? If you came from somewhere outside this argument, seems what I'm hearing.
Rupert, sure.
I don't see that as a fair representation of NFU Scotland's view. We seem to have lost sight that actually field sports, rural sports, because it's not just about deer, it is about shooting rabbit and pigeons and the rest of it, is a leisure activity. It's a leisure activity enjoyed by many of the rural poor. And round where I am, it is mostly the self-employed and people who don't have access to land who are doing those shootings. There is a real fear that actually an unintended consequence of this is it becomes a commercial concern, and therefore soon the only people that would be able to take part, if it became a purely commercial concern, would be parties, Europeans who paid significantly to come over and shoot over the land. And of course, if we take away the opportunity for this leisure activity from many in our rural areas, I'm sure they'll seek it out in other ways.
Can I just follow that up, Convenor? I mean, skirting around the description as a rural poor, which I think we could have a great debate about, but just skirting around that description, I wouldn't support anything in this legislation that was discriminatory against people who lived in the countryside. So I think you can take it as read, and you don't have to take my word for it, though I'll offer you my word on it. What we're trying to do, what I'm trying to do here, is to get to the stage where there is workable legislation that does not penalise small and medium-sized enterprises, that does not bear down unfairly and wrongly on deer management, which we want to see improved rather than made worse. So we're just trying to find a way through this. So let's take it as read that your objection, not the way you've put it, but your objection is taken. What I'm trying to say is there appears to be an element in this that I don't understand in terms of economic impact. Doug has argued for a full economic study. But actually, what I've heard is a succession of figures without any cogent proof that there would be an impact on rural employment. Where's that proof? Where's that going to be handed to the committee that there would be? I've heard good arguments that the state of the euro at present moment is impacting on people who come from other countries to take part in this. When are we going to see the proof that this is disadvantageous to specific people?
Doug, got it.
If I could go back to your previous question and then address that one. I think if I was coming down from outer space and looking at the situation across Scotland, I would be saying, look at these people who are prepared to invest private money on a huge scale into the operation of these landholdings, and look at what they deliver. I mean, and I would just commend anyone on the committee who hasn't seen this. This was the report by SRUC and the University of the Highlands and Islands that Fergus Ewing launched last week, which looks at exactly some of these issues and what the local communities think of that. So first of all, that's what I would be saying. And I was saying, let's value this and let's treasure it and let's use it in the right way. And as to your point about the evidence, I fully agree. And that's why we think this issue needs to be looked at in a lot more detail, because we're even at the moment trying to discuss what the mechanism might look like and how is it possible for an individual business to understand the consequences for them and their operation if they don't know how this is going to be operated, what it's going to cost, and hence what the impact on them is going to be. So, Mike, I agree with you. We need that diligence done.
You can make some assumptions from the discussion today. You've heard more of that discussion. There's more questions of the ministers to take place. So I would encourage your organisation in those circumstances to look at it, making those assumptions, and bring real evidence. Because I'm not unsympathetic to this debate, but I haven't seen that real evidence presented to the committee that says there are the people who are going to be affected. But I have heard discussions saying, well, if you impose this, then these people won't be employed. And that strikes me as an unfortunate way to deal with the government.
Two things, if I may, on that. First, we have surveyed our members to get a handle on, basically sport across Scotland and what the economic situation is. And as Colin said earlier, 90% of those said basically that their costs were more than their income for the operation. In terms of the sort of information you talked about, I think BASC has actually done some work on that, and there were some figures in their submission trying to estimate, as you actually said, about what this cost could be and hence what that would mean in terms of employment of gamekeepers. And I might pass on to Colin to go on that.
Yes, not specifically in employment of gamekeepers, because it is sort of hypothetical at this stage, but it's inevitable, I think, anyone looking from really high up would see that a tax that's being imposed on an activity, those who will pay the tax will ultimately be those who are enjoying the activity. So what concerns us is that the 100,000 people who enjoy sporting shooting in Scotland will ultimately have to pay the price of this, because it will be passed down from the farmer onto the rent, onto the syndicate. And the syndicate, a collective group of people who enjoy shooting, is the most common form of shooting in Scotland.
People who enjoy shooting, what would make them exempt from taxation? I mean, somebody at some stage is going to quote Emerson, so it might as well be me. You know, death and taxes are inevitable.
Yes.
So what makes that so special that it is not treated in this way?
We've already discussed exemptions for sustainable management, things like that. And what concerns me is that a large estate involved in wildlife state Scotland can demonstrate that they are behaving sustainably, but the small farm may not have the resources to go through that process. So the multitude of people who enjoy shooting in the form of small syndicates on farms may have difficulty in enjoying that exemption. That's what concerns me. It's ordinary working people, not just those who live in the country. The majority of them live in the central belt of Scotland or come to Scotland. These are the ones
so
ultimately will be paying.
If we exempted the small farm and the type of thing you're talking about, you would have no objection to this?
If small farms were exempted, then that would be good. But we are concerned that there's a collective effect, because the majority of small farms do not just have their farm business and their shooting business, but they're diversified into many other areas.
Taking that aside, if we were to exempt small farms and that type of shooting, you would be content?
I would still have concerns relating to the wider employment issues that Bruce alluded to on the larger estates.
Very hard to get people to be positive to convene a collapse.
Well, had
Pinky and Perky, yes.
Thank you.
Convener, I had Mr. Russell been able to join us on Monday, and I'd be interested in the panel's view on this. I fully accept his reasons for not being able to join us. We heard evidence from an individual who takes the shooting on an estate in the Borders and runs it as a commercial enterprise and employs 7 people in that valley. Now, in that area. His concern was that having to pay rates would make him very uncompetitive compared to similar businesses just south of the border, which is not far away from where he lives. Now I found that quite a powerful argument, because I dare say there is a level of rateable value that might be absorbed into the business, but there must be a level whereby that competitive argument comes into play, and I just wondered if anybody had a brief comment to make on that aspect of it.
Brief comments are welcome. Long comments are not.
I did say brief. I did say brief.
Doug, you did.
I would share his concern in that area, but there's obviously a particular geographic sort of rationale to that there as well. If I could just pick up a point Mike made about no taxes being paid, you know, I would remind the committee that estates do pay tax, and in these operations they'll pay income tax, they'll pay national insurance on employees, and they'll pay existing non-domestic rates where it's due in other parts of their business. So we're talking just perhaps one part of a much larger operation. And so I just wanted to make it clear that estates do pay tax where it is due.
The estate concern we're talking about has its business dealt with by CIC Montreal. Anyway.
Circumstance, yes, either, but there
indeed.
You go.
But I thought I would just add that little bit there. Dave Thompson.
It's just an extrapolation from some of the figures. 4 million is the estimate of the income. I think it was Colin mentioned 100,000 shooters. And I take Mike Russell's points about small farms being exempted and all that, but let's say for the sake of argument you divide 4 million by 100,000, it works out at £40 a year, 80 pence a week. Are we really saying that that level of taxation is going to destroy this shooting and all the rest of it?
I think if I'm right, the average level of tax before was something like £10,000. On the people who are on the valuation roll. Would that figure be correct? It was certainly of that order of magnitude. So I think if it was £40 a year, everyone would qualify for the small business bonus and it wouldn't be an issue. But until we've done the work to understand that, we can't say. Mm-hmm. But I think it was actually significantly more than that, which is why people are concerned.
Well, I'd be interested to see what others had to say, especially the assessors. But if it was 10,000, that by definition must have been much bigger operations and not the very small ones that were being mentioned that Mike Russell and others were talking about exempting. So it would make the point about the exemptions for the smaller ones. But it'd be interesting to hear what the assessor has to say on that.
I was there in 1995, and clearly that's maybe not the soundest of places to start because things have changed, as I said earlier. And we're talking here of averages. But I didn't take every valuation with me, but I've got some here, and these are from the Borders area, and shooting rights, Abbey St. Bathans, which I think is near Dunn's, at £155. And then you could go to Argyllshire, where there's sort of larger estates, and you'll find values at that time, which were £4,000, £7,100. Now, even if the smallest of those increased by a factor of 10, they're still not going to, as if small business bonus scheme applies, they're still not going to reach the threshold for paying any rates on that basis. But obviously that's a different matter than valuation. That's a rating relief matter, and that's not for assessors. That's for the government and the finance officers to deal with. But there are clearly a range of values, ranging from the sort of quite substantial to values in small hundreds at that time, and we have to now establish where that sits now.
I think indeed that little sequence there in terms of money, which we'll need to follow up. Thank you, Dave. I'm going to hand over the chair to my deputy, as I have to go and meet the First Minister.
Okay. Thank you. I think moving on, we're going to take a brief question from Alec Ferguson.
Yeah. I was going to ask about the whole process of assessment and all these things, but I think we've covered most of the whys and the wherefores. But there is an issue I want to ask Mr. McTaggart about, if I may. And it's one that we've sort of touched on it, but I'm still really unclear as to where we lie on it. And it goes right back to a question that actually I asked Mr. McLaren, the civil servant, when the civil servants were in front of us. Which, and I'd basically asked him, well, in fact, my exact words were asked him to confirm whether or not they are levied, rateable values will have to be applied to virtually every non-urban acre of land, acre, in order to identify those that are not to have sporting rates levied upon them. Now, the answer I got was not exactly clear, if I could put it that way. And I'm still not exactly clear on exactly where we lie with that. Now, I have anecdotal evidence that some of your colleagues believe that in order to meet their statutory duties, all sporting rights will have to be valued and entered on the roll, whether they're taken up or not. And I wonder if you're able to put on the record, for the sake of clarity, exactly what the position will be. Because my understanding is that really every acre or hectare of non-urban land will have to have a rateable value attached to it. As part of this exercise, can you confirm that or otherwise?
Yes. I think what we have to do is, in terms of the legislation as is proposed, then it says it is directing assessors to make an entry for all shootings and deer forests, to reintroduce entries for all shootings and deer forests, and that is tempered by the phrase insofar as exercisable, and we've discussed that earlier, what that may mean. That may mean a piece of ground where the shooting right cannot be exercised for one reason or another. To establish what needs to go into the valuation roll, assessors firstly need to identify the ownership and occupation of each and every piece of ground. Now, that's not something that's simplistic or straightforward to deal with. The valuation roll is valuation roll plus the council tax valuation list are probably the most extensive and current lists of property ownership and occupation in Scotland. What is exempt from that at the moment is agricultural lands and forestry lands. So what we have to do is examine all of that part of Scotland and establish what the current landscape is in terms of ownership, occupation and use. And once we've established that, we can then move to look at what the value of that is. And that's where it becomes that's the complex part of it from our point of view, and time-consuming part is establishing who's there, what they use it for, what's it worth. And once we've done that, we can then decide what entries should be made in the valuation roll and at what level. If the will of Parliament is that we do not enter certain classes of lands and heritages because reason A, B or C, then we maybe need to modify the terms of legislation, and that's where assessors and hopefully colleagues here would be willing to sit with the government officials and find a form of words that might temper the imposition of or the impact of these reintroduced provisions. But as they stand, then yes, we will have to look at every nook and cranny.
So the short answer to my question is yes. Yes. That's what I'm looking for. Yes. Thank you very much. No, not at all. Thank you. The explanation was useful too. Thank you very much.
Clarity. We are moving towards the conclusion of this session. I just want to open up an opportunity to colleagues if they have any additional questions they want to hear at this stage. No? Everyone content with that? Well, it just remains for me to thank the panel for what's been a very helpful and informative evidence session. It will certainly help inform lines of questioning for the government. Thank you very much. The next meeting of the committee is on the 7th of October, when we will consider three pieces of subordinate legislation and take evidence from stakeholders on human rights aspects of the Land Reform Scotland Bill. We will also consider the petition on the control of wild geese. As previously agreed, the committee will now move into private session to consider the evidence we've heard this morning. I now close the public part of the meeting, and I ask for the public gallery to be cleared. Thank you.